WIBC HD2 W298BB WIBC HD3 W228CX Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
Kevin, on the way in, I was thinking this morning about the fact that trying to prepare what it is that you say in a city that you and I both grew up in and have a great passion and heart and love and pride about, and you have a tragedy that happens, an unthinkable tragedy that takes place the day before that we're supposed to get on the air and have fun talking about sports, which we'll do this morning. And I thought to myself, what is it that we are to say or can say that is appropriate? Not that anyone would expect two people who talk about sports to have the appropriate things to say in these situations. But the only thing that I could think to myself, Kevin, was, I don't know, do we just re-rack what we said like 2 weeks ago?
Yeah. Yeah, Jake, and this is what, probably the third or fourth time we've let off a show. We've done this for less than a year.
Yeah.
With this, I find found myself driving in this morning just kind of looking up at the sky and thinking, we have not had a morning like this when we've done the show in months. I mean, it has been perfect sunny mornings
right.
every single day since really May. And sadly, it is probably a bit fitting what it looks like outside right now. So obviously, and again, just saying these words, it just feels like they just lose so much meaning. Because like you said, Jake, this seems to be part of the norm. But thinking about everybody involved with the families of the lives that were lost at Greenwood Park Mall. And then, Jake, a few hours later, Beach Grove Park. I don't know if you saw that as
I
well.
I did see that, yeah.
I believe one person lost their lives there and a couple injured. And, you know, I know you have fond memories of, was it Glendale Mall back in
Glendale
the day
and
for
Castleton.
You?
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
I mean, think about that. You know, I saw a 12-year-old was a victim last night. I mean, it's a rainy Sunday. Your whole day is looking forward to, hey, we're going to go to the mall later.
Yeah,
you know?
You're right.
You know, Maddie, Rosie, and I were at the food court of the Children's Museum yesterday. Like, that could have been us, you know? I hate to kind of bring it back and be a little selfish with that thought, but that thought certainly crossed my head. Across my mind yesterday. So
I think that's the thing, right?
I just hate that this becomes way too normal.
And, you know, what do we hear forever every time this happens, seemingly? But, you know, eventually it's going to be in your backyard, and, you know, here it is. I don't know. It is probably for other programs, perhaps, to opine endlessly on what the exact answers are. I think we all have our opinions on that. But the important thing, I think, is to simply say that we are, as I said the last time that a situation arose like this, which was, I believe, the Texas school shooting, we are certainly aware of the gravity of it. We are sad, just like anyone else, over the fact that people here within our own community are grieving. And you look at it like anybody else and say, we have to come up with a different approach, a different manner, a different fashion in which we are resolving our conflicts in this country. But at the same time, I do think that there are avenues and outlets when people have conflict going on emotionally with these situations that they escape to. And once again, you know, I understand the fact that this is a program, I think, where people go for that escape.
Sure.
And so I do not want people to think that we're not aware of it and not respectful of the gravity of it in a heavy morning this morning. And it's certainly on our minds as well. On a Monday, good morning to you. My name is Jake Query. Kevin Bowen, the other voice you heard. It is Kevin and Query here on 93.5, 107.5. The Fan, Mark Dykton, running the big board for us. I brought gifts for you guys back from Canada. Which
nice
we'll get
you.
To. But first off, Kevin, I assume you spent most of your weekend watching. You didn't have to watch Tiger Woods for long, though, right?
Oh, boy. Okay, 7:04. Yes, you are correct. Tiger did not sniff the weekend there. It's rest-up time for Tiger Woods now. He will have, in my opinion, 9 months off from competitive golf and give it a go at the Masters. But, Jake, oftentimes you get, you know, in the immediate aftermath of a sporting event, I think we speak in hyperbole a lot, and I try not to do that, and obviously I've slept on it. What Cameron Smith did yesterday in the final 18 holes, what he did on the back nine in particular, to be honest, Jake, and I know there's a lot of context that needs to go around this comment, Tiger Woods has never done that in a major. Tiger Woods has never shot 30 on the back nine and shot in 64 on a Sunday and run somebody down like Cameron Smith did. And we talked a little bit about this late last week. Rory McIlroy over there, Jake, and I say over there meaning Europe, is some combination of the crowd at IMS cheering for Ed Carpenter, Tony Kanaan, and Elio all in one.
Right.
I mean, he is beloved over there. It's Tiger times 10 of what Europeans and, you know, Scottish, whatever you want to call it, what they want to see out of their champion. And for Cameron Smith to say, kind of screw this Hollywood story, watch this. It's really one of the more remarkable final rounds ever in major championship history.
Now, what all, and pardon my naivete, my ignorance here, tell me what you can about Cameron Smith.
His mullet's awesome. Start there. As an Australian, they have a really rich golf history. I wouldn't say he was one of the most, this is the next star coming out of Australia. He was a good player, but not, they've had other guys in the 20s, age 20 is what I'm saying with that, that have been kind of crowned as, hey, the next Greg Norman, or, you know, the next Adam Scott, or Jason Day, or somebody like that. Cameron Smith was never that. And I'm sure you weren't watching a whole lot of it, Jay, because you were en route to the IndyCar race, but his putting, incredible. Like,
but he's been around a while, right?
Sure. He's a very, very accomplished player. You know, at the start of the week, I thought an Australian would play well here. Adam Scott was one of the sleeper picks that I had, but this is not a long shot by any means. I mean, he probably at the start of the week was what, one of the top 10 favorites to win the tournament. And his putting yesterday, it's not that he just made a bunch of putts. If you watch like how he made those putts, these balls are trickling in with the perfect pace and touch. He birdied his first five holes on the back nine. And I thought Rory McIlroy got a little bit, you know, football teams that have a lead late in games, Jake, and they run it on first down, and they run it on second down, and it gets to third and six, and they're like, "Ooh, watch this. We're gonna run a draw,
right?
You know, we're gonna catch this defense off guard here." I felt like that was a little bit of Rory yesterday, whereas Cameron Smith was, "Don't punt the ball to me, because I'm Patrick Mahomes on the other sideline, or I'm Tom Brady, Peyton Manning on the other sideline." Rory, I thought, defensive is probably one way to put it, but I just thought he was wishing to get to that 18th hole, and Cameron Smith just went and got it. So we'll have Will Haskett on at 8 o'clock to talk more about it.
8:30.
Thank you. That is now six straight major winners under the age of 30. First time we've ever gone a full calendar year with four major winners under the age of 30. But Cameron Smith's answer, Jake, after the round about LIV Golf, he definitely didn't say no.
So you went to the Children's Museum, did you say yesterday?
Yesterday,
they correct. Have a Scooby-Doo display there, is that correct?
They did. We did not venture to that. What did we do? We did.
How do you not go to the Scooby-Doo?
That thing is awesome. You missed the golden opportunity.
Yeah.
That thing is great.
We went dinosaurs to start off, ventured over. Rosie loves the Barbie exhibits. If she could have rode the carousel till sundown, she would have. We did that. You know, the carousel, Jake, I'm sure you know this. I was reading. She wanted Maddie to go on the carousel with her, and so I just kind of was watching from afar. I didn't realize it was at Broad Ripple Park previous.
Yes. Broad Ripple Park was actually, I've told this story before, but I find this fascinating, Kevin. Broad Ripple Park in the first half of the 20th century, certainly, was basically an amusement park. It was like the equivalent of Indiana Beach. I mean, obviously without a beach. Or Old Indiana Fun Park, that kind of a thing. And it had the carousel. It had the swimming pool at Broad Ripple Park was fantastic. And in the 1930s, I think I've told this story on this show probably a handful of times, but one of the lifeguards at Broad Ripple Park I believe it was prior to the 32 Olympics, was an Olympic hopeful in swimming. And there were a group of kids that were playing at Broadopple Park in the pool, and one of them lost their play ball, got sucked down underneath into the bottom of the pool, like in the bubbler or whatever they would have had in terms of the technology in the 30s. And they said, oh, well, the lifeguard can go get it. He's an Olympic-level swimmer. I mean, he can dive down and get your ball. And so he went down to retrieve the ball for the kid, and the suction actually got a hold of his swim trunks, and he drowned at Broadopple Park and was denied the chance to go to the Olympics. I only say that because I always found it fascinating that, like, an Olympic-level swimmer that was, like, a city champion. But Broadopple Park was the place to be, for sure. And when I was a kid, they had a train there, like an actual – they may have went during your childhood. It was probably around then when it went out. But they just had, like, a huge locomotive train that you could go and climb on. And, I mean, it was great. It was cool. Now it's – you know, obviously still there's a lot of cool things at Broadopple Park, but the Children's Museum, though, is fantastic.
It's unreal. It really
did you
is.
Ride the carousel, did you say?
Maddie and Rosie did.
Which did they go with, the lion or the tiger?
Rosie wanted the lion, and then a last-minute change to the horse. I thought it was pretty impressive by her to, you know, all of a sudden at the last minute say, no, lion, I don't want you. I want that horse over there. Uh-huh. So I don't think the lion is too pleased with that, judging by its facial expression. They also have a plastic glass exhibit. I know that can sound a bit confusing, but obviously kids playing with glass probably wouldn't go over very well. But like a really cool, like thinking of like, you know, blowing glass and those sorts of things. They had a really cool exhibit there. So yeah, it was a fun day, and it was obviously packed because we haven't had a day weather-wise like that on a Sunday in quite some time. It looked pretty good in Toronto weather-wise.
Toronto, the weather was fabulous both days. I mean, I got up Friday. And then Saturday and Sunday both, I mean, spectacular weather, probably 80 degrees, sunny, perfectly blue skies. Scott Dixon getting the win. Colton Herta was on the pole, and Dixon took the lead, 40% of the way through the race and really kind of never relinquished it. That ties Mario Andretti to Scott Dixon now for the most wins in IndyCar history. A.J. Foyt still 15 wins ahead of that mark, so one would think that A.J. Foyt's record is safe, but... it was a good race. It was an exciting race, and it was, for the most part, a clean race. I mean, there were a couple of incidents. You know, Felix Rosenquist and Alexander Rossi made contact, and Rossi kind of got punted out. But nobody, you know, no major incidents or anybody getting hurt, that kind of thing.
Quite the week for Ganassi Racing, right?
Yeah, man. Alex Palou, you had the whole controversy that we talked about with Palou and McLaren, and that, you know, on Friday in Toronto... Palou did a press conference and answered a lot of the questions there, and then went out and, you know, did not qualify well. And I can't remember if he had he had an incident before qualifying in the practice session. I don't know why I'm all choked up here. And then, so Palou started towards the back of the field and just kind of had a quiet day. I mean, it wasn't a terrible day. Like, he was, at one point, he was on the track battling with Marcus Ericsson.
Yeah, that got dicey for a second. I'm like, boy, if you wreck Ericsson,
can you imagine?
Chip Ganassi might meet you on the track.
Correct. But overall, the controversies around Alex Palou kind of blew over, if that makes sense. The Blue Jays were in town on Friday night. I think it was Friday night. Yeah, they were hosting Kansas City. I got into Toronto later, else I would have probably gone to the game at the Rogers Center. It's funny to me, Kevin. Have you been to Toronto?
A baseball park called the Rogers Center?
Yeah, that's the Sky Dome.
Yeah, I don't love the sound of that.
Well, Rogers is like their Verizon. Is the big, matter of fact, they may even be like sister companies. Like when you land in Canada, your phone tells you like you are now on Rogers Mobile or whatever. But
I have never been.
So Toronto is basically, I would say it's more like Chicago than New York, but it is a fabulous city, no question about it. But Toronto, I remember as a kid, you know, the Blue Jays played their original games at the stadium at Exhibition Park, which is right where the racetrack is now. As a matter of fact, where I was in turn 5 basically would have been the left field wall of the old Exhibition Park, where the Blue Jays played up until the early 90s when they opened up the Sky Dome. And the Sky Dome at the time was like this groundbreaking, like, oh man, it's awesome. It's got a retractable roof, and it's got a hotel in it with rooms like in center field. And it was, you know, I mean, 30 years ago, the Sky Dome was the creme de la creme. The World Series in 92 at the Sky Dome was like this state-of-the-art facility. And it's only 30 years ago. And you pass it now and you're like, ugh. It's just this kind of concrete, like, weird. I mean, it's a big building, but it's just kind of there. And, you know, then you think about it, you're like, baseball indoors, really? I mean, but we went to a game there. I went to Guns N' Roses at Sky Dome 3 years ago when we were there for the weekend. And then I went to a Blue Jays game once, and it's just a weird place to watch baseball. Just baseball indoors is odd.
You know, I was, and I said this to you last week, and reminded of it yesterday. By the way, the whole Peacock stream, it just seems a little off to me. I don't know if, like, blurry is the right word, and maybe it's just streaming in general. But, like, I'm watching it, and I'm like, I can clearly tell that this is not on cable network. Just the picture and the overall quality of it, but whatever. The shots of the race, it is so, I mean, you are right in the heart of downtown.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. It is the equivalent.
And it's not called the needle. What is it called? The
CN Tower.
CN Tower.
Yeah. So the racetrack for the Toronto race is at Exhibition Place, which is there, the equivalent, and it looks very similar to our fairgrounds. The buildings are the same. It's, you know, it's where they, I think the World's Fair may have been there at one point.
But a little bit more centrally located to downtown than maybe our fairgrounds. Or is that wrong?
Nah, probably about the same, to be honest with you. It's just the skyline, the CN Tower is so big, it looks like it's right there, right? So, no, yeah, you know what? You may be right. It would be the equivalent if it was at, like, 16th Street, probably. But the area looks almost exactly the same. And that's where they race. But the downtown is... The funny thing about Toronto, Kevin, like, we went to dinner Saturday night, and I'm like, you know what? I haven't had a cheeseburger in a while. I'm just going to do a cheeseburger. Well, they brought it out, and I kid you not, it was the equivalent of what we would call a slider. Like, portions from a food standpoint outside the United States, if you go to, like, when you go to Canada, you order dinner somewhere, it is like the portion size is like a kid's menu in the States. And they're like, yeah, because you people are obsessed with food. Like, we don't need to eat that much.
Well, that's why we have Joey Chestnut and they don't.
Now, that is correct. They do have Moosehead beer on tap, though. And you know what? Here's a great trivia question for you guys. And then, by the way, we will get into sports more this morning as well. Matter of fact, Will Haskett going to join us at 8:30. Scott Agness at 9 o'clock this morning. Did I get that right, or am I looking at Friday's roster?
No, you're right. Okay. 8:30 Haskett, 9 o'clock Agness.
I'm still in a fog, so you got to bear with me. What beer, what American beer is like the, like you go to any bar in Canada and they have like all the Canadian beers, and then what American beer on tap is like their, I'm trying to think of what here, like everyone drinks that's, you know, everybody here gets like Stella or.
Busch Light.
Okay, what's your guess?
I guess Miller Light or something like that.
This is one that was popular when I was in college. Like people, it was considered, when I was in college, if someone brought over a six-pack of this beer, it was like, ooh, woo, high flutin'.
Coors Light?
Schlitz.
Green bottles.
God, never even heard of it.
No, I'm just saying, they come in a green bottle. That's your hint. And on the back it had an inscription, and then it says 33 in quotations. And no one knows what the 33 means.
I was going to guess Larry Bird's Celtics jersey. In a
Rolling
green
Rock.
Mm-hmm.
Rolling Rock beer is huge in Canada.
Rock in a bottle is much better than Rolling Rock in a can. Yeah. I don't know if you've ever...
I think anything's better. You go can, then bottle, then draft, right?
Sure.
I don't think I've Rolling
only,
Rock.
I will only drink draft.
I think you brought this up, or maybe it was JMV brought this up with me a couple weeks back, but I was talking to my dad. He went to college at Indiana State, and he said that Coors Light, and my dad is, you know, in his early 70s, he said that Coors Light was so, you know, exclusive, if that's the
correct
right word, back then, that at one point they drove from Indiana State to Colorado strictly to him and another guy.
I totally believe this.
Strictly to fill up their car without however many Coors Light cases they could get in said car and drove back.
So
they have like a big party coming up that weekend.
I totally believe this, Kevin, because the rumor always was like it, you know.
And I love Coors Light. It's Coors Light.
Dude, it has water in it from the Colorado Rockies. It has to be refrigerated all the time, so you can't get it west of the Mississippi. That was always the narrative about it.
Gosh,
it was a big deal.
To me.
The same thing with Yingling. Do you remember Yingling before it came here? It was like people went crazy, right?
Yeah, and then there was that brief phase of like not your father's root beer.
Oh, that was crazy.
Dude, you got one of those? Where'd you get that from?
That not your father's root beer. I went into a liquor store and they had it. And I bought a six pack of it. And I'm like, wow, this is really good. And then by the second one, you're like, oh my gosh. Like, am I drinking syrup? It lasted like 6 weeks.
You do have a little glow. It was at the private aviation glow that I'm seeing.
I have a good story about the Border Patrol last night. I was very fortunate. I want to thank Graham Rahal sincerely because
he had a decent race, right?
He did. Finished fourth. He had a good run. He was fourth. His teammate Christian Lundgaard was eighth. Jack Harvey had a good run going and then had back-to-back trouble on the pit stops. Finished 19th. But look, Graham Rahal, you know, I know that there are people because I see it on social media, people that think because Graham Rahal is a second-generation driver, you know, oh, well, he's spoiled, whatever else. Listen, I saw it last night, actually, and I'll offer a little glimpse into this later in the show, but Graham Rahal is his own man. Like, I know that people think that Graham Rahal is just, no. Graham Rahal, like, Bobby Rahal pointed him in the right direction, but Graham has absolutely kind of blazed his own path here in terms of his own business ventures and other such things. He is on his own two legs. Let there be no doubt about that. And an extremely like thoughtful and kind person. I was very, very lucky because I was a late addition to travel to Toronto. I wasn't originally designed to go to that race. And then at the last minute, there was a change where I had to go. Not had to. I mean, I was thrilled to go. But we do some of the races. We split the travel, and some of us do it from here off of monitors. And that was designed to be me for Toronto. And at the last minute, there was a change that necessitated me having to travel. So I rode out with Michael Young. We had a lot of fun on the drive out on Friday. But you don't know with the border, of course. It's about a 9-hour drive, 9.5, depending on how long the border. It can be as little as 8, but, you know. So the race didn't end until close to 6 o'clock. And knowing that I had to be on the air this morning, knowing that there were some things going on, I had to be back this morning. And not like off, you know, I didn't want to drive until 3 o'clock in the morning, right? So I reached out to all of the teams to ask if anybody had a charter where I could buy a seat on the way back. And at the last minute, Graham Rahal last week, and I wasn't going to mention this, but I'm very grateful for it. Graham Rahal texted me and said, do you still need a ride back from Toronto? And I said, well, yeah, I do. And he said, well, I think we're going to get a plane. You can just ride with us. And I'm like, dude, are you serious? So it was myself, Jack Harvey, Bobby Rahal, and Graham Rahal. And not only was it really fun.
It's one of those I-step questions. Which one doesn't fit?
There's you zero know? Question.
Right.
Zero doubt about it.
Jake Query.
Right. No doubt about that. But it was fascinating.
Did you serve drinks? Did you pass out cheese and crackers?
I mean, I should have, right? Like, we got on the plane and Bobby Rahal was like, Jake, sit wherever you want, young man. Like, da da da. I mean, it's tiny, right? But it was really illuminating. It was really fascinating just to the dynamic between Graham Rahal and his dad talking not only about racing, but about, you know, Bobby Rahal was asking Graham about business, not the other way around. It was enjoyable. I mean, yeah.
To be a fly on the wall would be fun.
We dropped Bobby Rahal off. We left Toronto, flew to Detroit, had to do customs in Detroit, then got back up in the air and took Bobby Rahal to Northern Michigan where he's got a vacation home. And then Jack Harvey, Graham, and I flew from Northern Michigan to Indy. We got back at like 9:30 last night. But a million thanks to Graham Rahal. But it was fun and fascinating, and I'll tell a funny story after the check down about Border Patrol. But I also want to mention Graham Rahal does have a foundation. I'm going to tweet out a link for it, and I'm going to make a donation to his foundation, which helps out underprivileged and sick children, hospitalized children, to be able to kind of live normal lives. He also does a lot for veterans, and some of the money goes to that as well. So I figured I'd make a donation to that for the cost of an airline ticket. And then make people aware of that foundation as well.
I love that. And I think we should probably be thankful as well that you got a full night of rest. So thank you to the Rahals.
That's right.
Team Mayor for taking Jake literally under their wings. As Jake said, Will Haskett at 8:30, Scott Agness at 9 o'clock. We'll get into some Colts conversation today. We are a week and a day away from reporting to Grand Park for training camp. That is next Tuesday. The Pacers wrapped up Summer League last night. I went on Phoenix Radio on Friday after our show. They had an interesting take, a little bit of a kind of a counter take on Deandre Ayton and the Pacers situation that I want to throw at you guys as well. It is a gloomy Monday morning in Indianapolis. Kevin Aquari, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
The Ride with JMV.
Line 2's...
Yes, Kuiper the Rapper.
Oh, Kuiper. Tic-tac-toe?
Yes, sir.
That's you.
Let me bless you guys with a little quick verse before I go.
Do it.
My dad got up because he heard some knocking. Thought it was a quick me and he was rocket. Get to my room, opened up the door. He said, son, what you doing playing tic-tac-toe? That's X. And that's O. Is that sex? Well, maybe so.
That's awesome.
Tic-tac-toe. IJ, I'm out.
Dude, that's awesome.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
You need a lawn care pro and a pest control pro. You can have both in one guy, you. DoMyOwn.com will help you get there with pro products, pro knowledge, and pro support. DoMyOwn.com for the pro and you.
The amount of money our clients receive with a simple cash-out refinance is life-changing. Learn more and get pre-approved at TheHomeLoanExpert.com. NMLS number 1326-241.
The world's greatest Pink Floyd show, Brent Floyd, is back with brand new production for their world tour 2022. Featuring The Wall, Dark Side of the Moon, and more. Complete with a stunning multi-million-dollar light show, iconic circle screen, lasers, inflatables, and theatrics. Coming to Indianapolis this Sunday, July 24th at the Murat Theater at Old National Center. Tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com or OldNationalCenter.com.
My name is Kayla Sinders, and I work for Gleaners Food Bank. I am a local service manager for three counties in our 21-county service area, and I nominated Katie.
And I'm Jiffy Lube owner Steve Sanner. At Jiffy Lube, we are proud to support Hoosier charities that use their vehicles to do more to make Indiana a better place to live.
My name is Katie Wilkerson. I pick up at the mobile food pantries. The best part of volunteering to hand someone some food and see the smile on their face, the relief. Without my vehicle, there's no way I'd be able to do this. To go to any of the pantries, it's at least 18 miles.
Jiffy Lube of Indiana provides all of our Do More winners with free vehicle maintenance for a year. Because now at Jiffy Lube, our trained technicians do more to keep vehicles like theirs and yours on the road. Brakes, tires, batteries, and more. As well as Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
If you know a volunteer who impacts your community, nominate them today to receive a year's worth of free vehicle maintenance. Just click the Do More tab at JiffyLubeIndiana.com.
Hey, it's JMV here for John and Chris Love. That's Love Heating and Air, 317-353-2141. I would not trust anybody else with my cool and comfort in-house and making sure that my system is running efficiently. If you feel as if yours isn't, 353-2141. Get that checkup from John and Chris Love at Love Heating and Air, making sure it doesn't cost you money and you remain cool and comfortable. Love Heating and Air, 317-353-2141 online, love-hvac.com today.
Hey guys, wondering what Urology of Indiana can do for you? They are your one-stop practice for world-class men's urologic health needs. Not only do they treat general urology conditions, their board-certified urologists perform vasectomies every day of the week, all year long. And they have multiple vasectomy clinics, so chances are good there's one close to you. Urology of Indiana also has Central Indiana's only center with a team of fellowship-trained men's health physicians, offering a comprehensive approach to ED, sexual dysfunction, and other men's health conditions. And they have a renowned prostate cancer program that offers the most advanced treatment options, nationally recognized for patient outcomes. Now is a great time to see a urologist. Call Urology of Indiana at 877-362-2778 to schedule an appointment. That's 877-362-2778. Or visit urologyin.com for more information. That's urologyin.com.
In the construction business and can't find what you need, Quality Supply and Tool has served Hoosiers for over a quarter of a century. Tom Hawk is the branch manager of the Indy location on South Harding Street.
We've always been big on keeping our shelves fully stocked of inventory of industrial-grade tools, concrete, masonry products, as well as the necessary accessories to help get the job done. You don't have it, you can't sell it. Our experience allows us to help with getting the pros as well as the weekend pro taken care of.
Quality Supply and Tool also has locations in Bloomington and Jeffersonville to help you think outside the box. Store.
Sip and save at Circle K with our great new drink subscription. Join Sip and Save today and enjoy one drink a day every day for just $5.99 a month. Enjoy your favorite Circle K ice cold fountain drink, Froster, or freshly ground coffee every day. That's 30 drinks a month for only $5.99. So sip and save at Circle K. Sign up in store or at CircleK.com. Circle K, take it easy.
Radiant Raspberry, Golden Orange, Ice Blue. You'll find all the colors of summer in our selection of beautiful, natural sapphires. Every color imaginable. At Shane Company, we're gemstone experts and our passion shows. Tom Shane selects our sapphires and rubies individually, by hand, in Bangkok, the gemstone capital of the world. He brings back the most spectacular sapphires, bold and vibrant colors, as well as soft pastels like peach and lavender. We also have yellow citrine, green quartz, London blue topaz, a rainbow of colors, and one-of-a-kind stones sourced by Tom. At Shane Company, we're known for our beautiful gemstones. Come into the store and try on our jewelry, or use our fun virtual try-on tool on your phone. Whether it's sparkling earrings for the poolside, a gemstone pendant for a concert in the park, or a vibrant center stone for your engagement ring, our colorful gemstones will brighten your day.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business, Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
The Morning Checkdown. Omaha! Brought to you by QC Kinetics. Relieving your joint pain at QCKinetics.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
All right, Major League Baseball is hitting the All-Star break. Tonight, it is the Home Run Derby there from Los Angeles, I should say. The hottest team in baseball right now, the Seattle Mariners, winners of 14 in a row. And the Mariners certainly turned things around. Yesterday was kind of a cancellation day across many of the Midwest. Probably a good thing the Reds got postponed because the Cardinals continue to do what the Cardinals do to the Reds. Guardians and Tigers postponed as well. Cubs desperately needed a W, and they got one over the Mets.
Cubs desperately 3-2, right? One, but they did get one, yeah.
3-2 over the Mets. How about the White Sox? 11-0 over the Twins yesterday. It was the Yankees 13-3 over Boston. Tampa over Cute Fella 7-5. Yesterday in Toronto, it was Scott Dixon, Kevin, as you had mentioned, sailing his way to victory. He is now tied Mario Andretti for career wins, correct?
And here was Scott Dixon afterwards, untying one of the all-time greats, 52 career W's.
Yeah, it means a lot. You know, I love Mario. I love Mario for so many reasons. You know, what he's done in the sport, what he's achieved, what he gives back to the sport. And you know, I keep saying, you know, I feel extremely lucky to have the likes of himself and AJ here most weekends, you know, and even to sit and chat with these guys. You know, their stories are obviously the generations that they raced in, or the generation and time that they raced in was a lot different from now. And you know, it means a lot to me. You know, to even be mentioned in the same conversation as these greats, you know, I never thought it was possible. You know, so
Jake, your top five: Scott Dixon, Colton Herta, Felix Rosenquist, Graham Rahal, Marcus Erickson, and then in the news headline over the last week, Alex Palou finishing sixth.
You know, it's interesting when Scott Dixon says right there, like, you know, I never would have guessed that I'd be in the same breath as Mario. Look, we are seeing before our very eyes one of the careers of, I mean, an all-time great, obviously. I mean, he's tied now for second all-time in the wins list in IndyCar. And, you know, 75 years from now, when if racing still exists, people will be talking about, like, man, that, you know, Scott Dixon's numbers, I mean, he's going to be, you know, it's like when people look back and it feels like with baseball players, Kevin, like Rogers Hornsby or, you know, Honus Wagner. Like, there are great names that who statistically are just as big as the Roos, the Aarons, the DiMaggios, but their names are not as big. Jimmy Fox, he feels like that because he's not overly dynamic from a personality standpoint, but from a driver standpoint, absolutely. NBA Summer League complete. The Portland Trail Blazers, your winner. Did you see who was the MVP of the Summer League Championship?
Yeah, Christian Watford's brother.
That is correct. Right? Trendon Watford, who is strictly Trendon Watford everywhere else but Indiana, where he's Christian Watford's little brother, right?
LSU products.
Correct.
Yeah, the Trail Blazers won the Summer League. The Pacers lose to the Suns yesterday. We'll have Scott Agness on at 9 o'clock to talk a little bit more about that. And the British Open yesterday, Jake, it was Cameron Smith with one of the really Sundays to remember in major championship history, with seemingly all of Europe wanting Rory McIlroy to get it done. It was Cameron Smith shooting 30 on the back nine, 64 for the championship, finishing at 20 under par, and wins his first major.
Do you know the Australian link to Britain? Do you know how Australia began?
Oh, gosh. I should know this off the top of my head.
Mm-mm. It was literally a prison colony. Like, if you commit, that fella committed a crime, we'll send him to that big island, and they'd send people to Australia.
That's quite the big island.
It is, yeah. That. Yeah, that's right. Wait a minute. They have better steakhouses there. But yeah, they sent them off, and that was how. I mean, obviously you had the Aboriginals and the right. Natives. Right? Aboriginals, I think, are Australian. I know New Zealand, certainly.
How about
but you
this?
Had natives, but I mean, that's how it got really colonized.
Oh, this for Rory. Third player in the last 50 years to finish eighth or better in all four majors and not win one. I saw a stat yesterday. He beat 97.5% of golfers in major championships this year, but did not win any of them. It was Scottie Scheffler at the Masters, Justin Thomas at the PGA Championship, Matthew Fitzpatrick at the U.S. Open, and then yesterday, Cameron Smith wins the British Open, and now we continue to watch the world of golf as LIV versus the PGA Tour becomes center stage until we get to the major season next April. We'll talk with Will Haskett about that at 8:30. Scott Agness back from the Summer League at 9 o'clock. We come back, we'll get into a little bit of Colts conversation. We are a week and a day away from report day at Grand Park. This is pretty much wrap up summer vacation if you're a Colt player, and get ready to come back to Indianapolis and up to Westfield for, what is it, fifth year at Grand Park? Does that sound right? Fourth, fifth, something like that?
Wow, that time fourth flies, fifth, man.
Yeah, for training camp up there. We'll chat about that next here on Kevin and Corey, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
The NASCAR Cup Series races at the Verizon 200 at the Brickyard. Coverage next Sunday at noon on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Dear driver, thank you. Thank you for slowing down when you saw the orange cones and road construction signs. My husband is one of those road workers. And today, you saved his life. If you hadn't slowed down, you would have missed that lane change, driven right into the work zone, and you would have killed him. Because you were driving differently, he'll be at our son's Little League game this weekend. He'll be there to walk our daughter down the aisle. He'll be out there tomorrow, making Indiana's roads safer. Thank you.
When driving in a construction zone, be smart, be alert, be in the zone.
This is Kelly Watson, business manager of Labor's Local 1112. Everyone deserves a safe place to work. Do your part in the cone zone. Slow down, save a life. We're all in this together.
A message from Indiana's District Council of Laborers International Union of North America and affiliated locals.
Here's what's happening with The Fan.
The Ride with JMV is ready to come and hang out at your house for a backyard broadcast. Brought to you by Evan Williams Bourbon, Connecticut Home Water Systems, and New Belgium Brewery. Enter online for a chance to have JMV do his show live from your backyard. And head to the Fan contest page online for a chance for you to win a four-pack of tickets to the Indiana State Fair. Friday, July 29th to Sunday, August 21st.
For more info, click on 1075thefan.com.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in realty, Mark Deedle Realty. 317-755-4232. That's 317-755-4232. Online, markdeedle.com. That's Mark DIETEL.com. Today. So how about Randy in Indianapolis had a rental property he was ready to sell to cash out in on a hot market. Selling fast was good, but more importantly, he was looking to sell for the top dollar. Mark Deedle delivered on both. He got 20 offers and sold for $15,000 over the asking price in just a few weeks. That's why Mark Dietl's the best. Mark Dietl has a guarantee for you. Multiple offers on your home in 3 days, or he is going to list it for free. That's Mark Dietl Realty, 317-755-4232, 317-755-4232. MarkDietl.com, that's Mark DietL.com today.
Hi, it's Steve Mann. Have you heard the commercials for the Mark Patrick Stop Smoking Seminars? And they said only $49.99 and it could work for you. So I thought, that's not even a week's worth of smoking. So I went. And guess what? It did work for me. You know, my friends and family are still amazed. I quit smoking. I didn't have cravings, anxiety, or weight gain. Listen, I don't know how it works, but I know it works because I'm living proof and it's 100% guaranteed. So what do you got to lose? I'll tell you what you got to lose. A very bad habit.
Join Mark Patrick Seminars and stop smoking now without cravings, irritability, weight gain, or your money back. Only $49.99 guaranteed. Designed to work without anxiety, irritability, or weight gain for only $49.99, become a non-smoker. That's right. Seminar times are 8 to 10 p.m. on Thursday, July 28th at the Hampton Inn & Suites in Fishers and 2 to 4 p.m. on Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn & Suites South in Indianapolis. Registration 30 minutes before seminar.
It's Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
20 minutes before the hour of 8 o'clock, Jake Query, Kevin Bowen here. It is Kevin and Query, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan. On a Monday, how are you? And that means, Kevin, that as you had mentioned, 1 week from tomorrow, everything getting underway for the Colts, which is hard to believe, is it not?
It is. And, you know, I'd probably say something to that effect like every July 18th. But, yeah, 1 week from today, or 1 week from tomorrow is report day, the first practice up at Grand Park. A week from Wednesday, and just to remind everybody, pretty much the training camp schedule will unfold with noon practice times and the most popular days. They're up there for about a month, starting July 27th all the way until late-ish August. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. That's the most popular day. You will see them up at Grand Park practice times around noon to 1:30, noon to 1:50 each and every day. You know, Jake, I've said this really, I think, ever since the A.J. Brown trade happened. I feel like this is the most confident I've been with the Colts in the AFC South in quite some time. But I also, and I posted this on 107.5thefan.com earlier today, I count probably five legit starting position battles up for grabs, and I think that's the most in quite a while for the Colts entering training camp. And some of them at very prominent spots as well. So it's kind of interesting how there is this level of confidence. Those in Vegas penciling the Colts in as a definite favorite in the AFC South. But when you look at their depth chart right now, I think there is a legit, probably five, open starting jobs that I think will be decided during training camp in the preseason.
Okay, so the positions that are locked are the most obvious, right? So give me the position battle, Kevin, that, I mean, wide receiver's obvious, right? I mean, we know that Michael Pittman is their one, you know. I mean, I'm looking right now up at the screen, and one of the television networks is doing a thing on the NFL, who will be the best receiver in the league this season, and they're showing highlights of Michael Pittman Jr. Is that overly optimistic? I don't know, but I think we know he's the number one. The battle for who becomes the secondary receiver, you know, probably is maybe on. I don't know.
Yeah, oh yeah, definitely, yeah.
But having said all of that, give me the position that is up for grabs that would most surprise people.
Well, I would think, with what happened to the Kari Willis retirement last month, the fact that you do have a starting job up for grabs at safety, where it looked like, you know, Julian Blackman and Kari Willis were going to be your definite safeties moving forward. And again, Julian Blackman, the fact that he went through the spring very healthy, participated extremely close to 100%. That is huge for him coming off the torn Achilles that he suffered in practice last October. Offensively, Jake, I see three open position battles. I see wide receiver two, like you mentioned, and really just playing time behind Michael Pittman. How do you divvy that up? It's very much up in the air. And then for the first time in the Frank Reich era, this will be year five for Frank Reich, he will enter a training camp where he will have two open starting offensive line spots. Left tackle being the very prominent one, Matt Pryor versus Bernard Raimann. You are just littered with inexperience there. Matt Pryor's inexperience comes from not playing left tackle a whole lot. Bernard Raimann, the rookie out of Central Michigan. And then right guard would be the other one. Mark Glowinski exiting in free agency. Chris Reed is now in Minnesota, a guy that spent some time over there. And probably the favorite at right guard would be a guy that we had on the show last year after he caught a touchdown. That would be Danny Pinter from Ball State, who has never played right guard either in his career. So it probably hasn't gotten a ton of attention this offseason, but I think one of the reasons why the Colts feel so good about the Matt Ryan situation is they believe he'll come here and he'll be behind a much better offensive line. And while the Colts still have three really good and you know, in some cases, great offensive linemen in Quentin Nelson, Ryan Kelly, and Braden Smith, I think it's fair to say the O-line group as a whole, they were not at an elite level last year. They were at a good level, but I don't think they were at an elite level. And now you're incorporating two new starters. Does that position group get back to being an unquestioned strength for this team? Because I think you need it to be there to make up for maybe what you lack at wide receiver and tight end.
The thing that I think is interesting or fun about camp is strictly there's always somebody. Did Chris Ballard just walk in here, Mark? What the hell just happened?
Is your mic on?
No.
Oh, sorry.
I was pulling audio, and then you turned your mic off, and
I didn't turn. I didn't touch my mic.
Oh well, somebody did.
Well, you did because you're pulling audio over there. Can you pay a little better attention?
Not me, liar.
Good to see we're all good chemistry here to start this Monday morning.
It's Monday.
Here we go.
I don't know.
Thinking myself, I've had headphone issues for about the past week. I'm like, I can't hear Jake.
It's also
on
like,
my end.
Is it just me or is it like 95 degrees in here?
It's always hot. It's either hot or cold. There's no middle.
What I was going to say, sorry, about camp that fascinates me always.
You got to go back 20 seconds to what you were going to say.
That's right. Okay. We'll start all over again here. The thing that's always fascinated me about camp, Kevin, is, you know, seemingly there are always two players. One is the player that arrives in camp and just plays really well over the course of camp and becomes an out-of-nowhere star that you think is going to make the roster, but then in the end, they end up putting him like on the practice squad because there just isn't room. And then the other is a player that shows up in camp that no one pays attention to that does make the roster kind of off the radar. And all of a sudden, you're like, really? And then that guy ends up making a contribution like in week 9. You know what I mean? And the Colts have had, Kevin, we've talked about this, in terms of undrafted free agents making the roster, the Colts have been as good with that as anybody, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they've had a long history of undrafted guys. I mean, this guy doesn't necessarily fit that criteria, Jake. But when Ryan Grigson made the signing of Mike Adams, boy, this had been like June 2014, I want to say. I don't think a lot of people paid much attention to it. And then all of a sudden, Mike Adams becomes a starting safety for you and actually played at a Pro Bowl level. Now, that is one of the other starting jobs that's open. If you look on defense, I think the front seven is pretty much locked in. I think you know exactly what your D-line and your linebackers are going to look like. Obviously, the Darius Leonard health situation is there. But I would say, who is that third corner? Stephon Gilmore and Kenny Moore, assuming Kenny Moore does not hold out. Those would be your two top corners. Now, Stephon Gilmore and how much he plays, I think, will be something to keep an eye on. He's 32 years old. He was injured last year. He didn't play every single defensive snap. But I would say in the secondary, that nickel corner, which, again, that third cornerback that is so often needed, and then who lines up at safety, which is a veteran versus a rookie. It's Nick Cross, the rookie out of Maryland. We talked with Mike Loxley, his college coach, back earlier in the summer. This is a guy that's very young. I don't even think he's turned 21 years old yet. But when Chris Ballard traded up for him, I was like, what in the world? This is so unlike Chris Ballard. Why is he doing this? He would be a guy that will be competing with Rodney McLeod. And Rodney McLeod is probably more in the Mike Adams side of the resume. Veteran. He's been a full-time starter for nearly a decade. And one of those two, the veteran and McLeod or the rookie and Cross, I think that is a position battle next to Julian Blackman.
I wanted to pass along one other thing and get a little more into this before. And again, Will Haskett going to join us at 8:30. We'll continue the Colts conversation in the 8 o'clock hour as well. But so last night I had mentioned, Kevin, I got into a bit of a pickle in terms of my return from Toronto, in terms of the travel, because it was important to be back this morning to do the show. And I had driven out to Toronto. You know, things now, there are charters that go for IndyCar, but I was a late addition. I was not supposed to go to Toronto. So the easiest way to say it, short way to say it, is that I was kind of in a pickle to get back to Indianapolis. The commercial flights to come back after the race, the race was a later start. There were all kinds of factors involved. So I was seeking a way home from Toronto when Graham Rahal reached out to me and said, hey, listen, we've got a plane. You can fly back with us, which I was very grateful for. And so I had mentioned that I flew back last night with Bobby Rahal, Graham Rahal, Jack Harvey, and myself. And Graham refused to accept. I mean, I said like five different times, I'm like, listen, man, like what can I do? Like, can I pay you? No, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
Grab the bags, Jake.
Right, basically. So we flew from Toronto first to Detroit, and we had to land in Detroit. It was funny. Bobby Rahal, there should be a reality show of a camera that just follows around Bobby Rahal. I will say that. Like, I don't know him well, but it was just like, he's just a funny guy. I mean, it was just funny stuff, like his reaction to stuff. But when we landed in Detroit, customs had to come on, and they took all of our passports. And they took Jack Harvey's passport and his visa, because he's, of course, a British citizen. Jack Harvey's visa says on there that he is an athlete and a race car driver. So these two guys from customs take our stuff, and they disappear for like 20 minutes, and they come back. And we're just standing there because we had to deboard the plane. So the customs guy comes back and goes, holy cow, this is the coolest thing ever. You're a race car driver? And he says this to Jack Harvey, and Jack Harvey's like, yeah, and he's handing his stuff back to him, and he goes, so, like, have you ever run the Indy 500? And Jack Harvey goes, yeah, I have, mate, like a couple of them. And he goes, dude, like, you haven't won it, have you? And Jack Harvey says, no. And he goes, because that would be so awesome to be able to say that I did the customs boarding for a guy that's won the Indy 500. Bobby Rahal's just standing there, says nothing, by the way. But I want to make this very clear, and I'm going to tweet this out. But Graham Rahal, and I know I mentioned this earlier, I know that there are people that think that Graham Rahal is like, oh, well, you know, he's a lucky kid that his dad gave him, you know, whatever. I was a fly on the wall for a lot of the conversation that was taking place on the flight between Graham and Bobby Rahal. It was not Graham Rahal following the guide of his father, which it was Bobby Rahal listening to Graham Rahal and asking Graham questions about the business that Graham has built, his custom car business, a lot of the stuff about the race team. Graham was very, like, in tune with all of that, and Bobby Rahal, I could tell, a proud dad, but was listening in. But Graham Rahal also, we started talking about, and he was telling me about the foundation that he has with his wife, Courtney Rahal. They partner their money, and he's raised, you know, nearly $500,000 for Turn for Troops, Soldier Strong USA, and for One Cure, which is a program through Colorado State University that's trying to cure cancer, as well as he's done a ton for children, you know, sick children to be able to go to summer camps. That was kind of started by Paul Newman. But the vast majority of the funds that he raises goes to Turn for Troops and Soldier Strong USA, which helps military veterans. And I was in a conversation with Graham Rahal, notably the last third of our flight, where he talked almost exclusively about his admiration for the veterans and the military people of this country. And you want to talk about a guy that was as patriotic in talking about it, Graham Rahal was exactly that. And he is dedicated towards raising money to helping guys and gals who have come back from service overseas. And he's just gotten to know so many of them. I'm going to tweet out the link to his foundation because I'm telling you, he's passionate about it. He absolutely believes in it and he's invested in it. And it was impressive. All of it was impressive to be able to see a glimpse kind of behind the curtain of more than just the driver, Graham Rahal.
I might have the money value wrong, Jake, but isn't it like $100 for every lap he leads throughout the IndyCar season he donates?
Correct. Well, it's so many for every that he turns. Like he raised the turn
every
for
lap
troops,
that he races.
Correct.
It's not, okay, yeah.
So he raised $4,250 yesterday for turn for troops, and he always makes it a point to point that out. But I mean, I'm telling you, like he has gotten to know so many of these veterans. He was telling me story after story yesterday of veterans that he knows of the combat that they've seen, the trauma they've been through, the rehabilitation they've been through. And he truly cares about it. Like, it's impressive. He truly cares and knows and follows it. And so every dollar that's raised, I can promise you the Graham and Courtney Rahal Foundation, it's going towards the right place.
And you're going to tweet out that link you said?
I will, yep.
Yeah, it hasn't been a great season for Rahal Letterman Racing, but yesterday I think qualifies a pretty good day. Not only Graham in the top 10, but Christian Lundgaard as well, finishing in the top 10. All right, Will Haskett's going to join us around 8:30. Scott Agness at 9 o'clock, and I want to hit on that when we come back. Mentioned it a little bit earlier, went on Phoenix Radio Friday afternoon, and they were relatively surprised at something the Pacers did in relation to that Deandre Ayton offer sheet, and I'll explain more of that when we come back here. It's a gloomy Monday morning in Indianapolis. Kevin and Query, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
School is in session.
LaFonso Ellis, how difficult is it to take a team in the lottery and improve them?
It's hard, unless you're getting one of those generational players. I always call it a learning curve of how to play in the league. I look at Indiana. I love some of the young pieces that they're bringing in. They could use a big-time veteran player to smooth the transition of the younger guys into Pacer basketball.
Dan Dockage, weekdays noon to 3 on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Armor Air is more than a heating and cooling company. They cover it all. Their service fee is only $29. ArmorAir.com. Day or night, they do what's right.
Right now, it's a seller's market. I'm Patrick Keller with Crestpoint Real Estate. Get your free home value estimate from me in 60 seconds at sellwithpatrick.com.
Hey, it's JMV. Race Trash Services, the largest independent recycling and waste solutions provider in the Indianapolis area, and right now, they're looking for great people to join the team. Raise is a family-operated business and has been providing Central Indiana with industry-leading recycling and waste disposal solutions since 1965. They focus a lot on the culture to make it a great place to work. Go to racetrash.com to see the career opportunities waiting for you. That's racetrash.com today. Raise, your recycling and waste solutions partner.
NASCAR and IndyCar action return for Brickyard Weekend at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. Saturday, July 30th, catch a doubleheader featuring the NTT IndyCar Series Gallagher Grand Prix, followed by the NASCAR Xfinity Series Pennzoil 150. Then Sunday, the 31st, the NASCAR Cup Series Verizon 200 at the Brickyard. Experience the roar and power of NASCAR and the speed and precision of IndyCar in one exciting family-friendly race weekend. Kids 15 and under, get in free. Get your tickets now at IMS.com.
Mom, Dad, you should shop Amazon for back to school and save some money. See, I'm currently obsessed with superheroes and need all the superhero stuff. Superhero lunchbox, superhero backpack. But next year, it'll be something else. Maybe dinosaurs? I don't know. I'm not a fortune teller. But I can tell you not to spend a fortune and shop low prices for school on Amazon. Okay, good chat. Amazon. Spend less, smile more.
Hey, Indiana, we've hit the halfway point of the baseball season, and you can turn big hits and dingers into big wins with FanDuel Sportsbook before the Midsummer Classic. Right now, new customers get $150 in free bets guaranteed when you place your first $5 bet. All you have to do is sign up with promo code MARK to get in on the action. FanDuel lets you bet the money line, home run props, strikeout totals, and so much more. Plus, you can combine your bets for an even bigger payday with the same game parlay. If you haven't tried FanDuel, now is the perfect time to give it a shot. Just join with promo code MARK and turn a $5 bet into $150 in free bets, win or lose. Also, check out their everyday odds boosts and specials. Dinger Tuesdays, my favorite promotion during the baseball season. I love it. Check it out. And with, you know, they've got the Home Run Derby tonight. Throw some money on a guy you think will win the Home Run Derby. I've got a financial interest in Kyle Schwarber. So check it out. FanDuel Sportsbook, the only place to bet baseball on the Midsummer Classic and all stuff going forward. Turn a $5 bet into $150 in free bets, win or lose. Again, exclusively on the FanDuel Sportsbook app, plus the app is safe, secure, and easy to use. And when you win, you get paid quick. Must be 21 and over in Indiana. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued is non-withdrawable free bets that expire 14 days after receipt. See full terms at FanDuel.com/sportsbook. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Real people are getting real and lasting pain relief at QC Kinetics.
Who would have thought that I would be in better shape now than after I got out of the Marines at 22?
It's great to be active again.
I've played 36 holes multiple days in a row without pain. Everything's great.
Are you tired of living with chronic joint pain? QC Kinetics uses cutting-edge regenerative medicine to restore and repair damaged tissue. Natural healing agents from your own body, so your body can heal itself the way it was designed. With no pain pills, no steroids, no drugs, and no downtime.
It was super successful, and I recommend everyone seek out QC Kinetics as an alternative to surgery.
Thanks to QC Kinetics, quality of life is just a lot better.
Definitely changed my life.
Call now to see if regenerative medicine could be the answer you've been looking for. The local medical professionals at QC Kinetics have proven protocols that can give you lasting relief now. And the consultation is free.
Call QC Kinetics 463-235-7160. That's 463-235-7160 in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. 463-235-7160.
93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
WIBC HD2 W29 ABB. WIBC HD3 W228CX Indianapolis.
Baseball's best face-off in L.A. at the Major League Baseball All-Star Game. Tomorrow night at 7 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
8 o'clock hour here on Kevin and Querry on a Monday. We mentioned this to open up the show, and I think it deserves mention again, Jake, but sadly, found it a bit fitting driving in this morning, and for the better part of the past month or two, we have had just some glorious mornings, picture perfect, no cloud in the sky, sunny, and this Monday morning, very gloomy and overcast here in Indianapolis, and again, sadly, it comes on the heels of what we saw last night at the Greenwood Park Mall, where four people died and a couple more injured, and then a few hours later, over at a park in Beech Grove, someone shot and killed, a couple more injured. And Jake, I just find myself, and unfortunately we've had to do this multiple times throughout the history of our show, which is not even a year old, where you see these events and you see them at places where we all go for an escape.
Oh, yeah.
For joy. We look forward to the entire week to go to the mall or go to the park or just get out of the house. And we've worked Monday through Friday and you're really looking forward to doing something fun with family and friends. And that to me just adds further. There's so much tragedy involved with the event itself, but when it's happening at places like that, obviously schools, parade, etc., it just pisses me off.
Yeah, I think, and that's a fair way of saying it, Kevin. You know, I don't know. I mean, we all can opine as to what the source of this terrible state that we're in, what's leading to all of these events. We can all speculate on that. But I think at the core, you know, listen, I grew up in this town, as did you. And I always had, I still do have this incredible pride of Indianapolis. I love being from Indianapolis. I love every time, like I did last night, I fly home. I don't care where I'm coming from. When I look out that window and I see Indianapolis below me, you know, I feel this great sense of comfort in being in my hometown. And so when I'm somewhere else and I'm reading about, or I'm, you know, in a different part of the country and I'm reading about, or for this, in this case, out of the country, and I'm reading about stuff that's taking place in Indianapolis, obviously it's heartbreaking and it's gut-wrenching and it's maddening. It's maddening. And to your point, Kevin, this is happening to people oftentimes in the areas that people consider their safe place, not just their safe place in terms of being safe from flying bullets or violence, but being safe from the things that emotionally get you down. And so the dichotomy for the two of us is to be aware of the fact that we need to recognize that people's comfort areas are being compromised, while at the same time understanding that talking about it routinely on this program is in fact contradicting that, because this program would be where a lot of people are going. I'm not saying you and I, but talking about right. sports is where a lot of people go to enter into the comfort arena and step away from that that bothers
yeah,
them.
Yeah, certainly.
So it is important to let people know that we're aware of it, that, you know, we're concerned about this community. But I have always felt like being able to do, and I do to the best of my ability, what we can to help out and aid this community during the parameters of this 3 hours, that aid and assistance, albeit perhaps, you know, sounding like we're not aware of it, is in fact just to concentrate on what our job is, which is to create for people hopefully some levity and a little bit of information on this program. Mark, the motto of the program, for example?
Educate and entertain.
That's right.
Yeah, we are very much on the same page with that. Again, Will Haskett is going to join us here at the bottom of the hour to talk about yesterday's British Open, and really one of the finest performances you will ever see, although ruining a Hollywood script and Cameron Smith shooting 64 to win the British Open. And then Scott Agness at 9 o'clock to talk Pacers. Jake, I went on Phoenix Radio on Friday afternoon, and they were curious about how Pacers fans were reacting to the Deandre Ayton offer sheet from Indiana and the fact that Phoenix matched said offer sheet so quickly. And I guess full transparency here, you know, I've covered the NFL now, I guess, for about close to a decade. I find myself much more ingrained, and it's much more easier to follow the NFL's cap situation and the contract jargon, if you will, that goes with it than the NBA. I think the NBA is so complicated with trade exceptions and bird rights and all these things.
Right.
It just, oh my gosh, honestly, you should see if you can find a course in it too, and I might take it with you if you do find that. And basically what these radio hosts were saying in Phoenix was that they felt like the Suns were going to match any basic offer sheet the Pacers offered Deandre Ayton. 4 years, $133 million. We heard it last week, the biggest offer sheet in NBA history, obviously something the Pacers don't typically do. But they mentioned that they felt like the offer sheet handed from Indiana to Deandre Ayton, let's say it's on a 1 to 10 scale of 10 being the greatest offer and the Suns being, oh my gosh, I don't want to match that. That is scary to match that. And 1 being, yeah, we'll offer you a bag of chips. The Pacers gave Deandre Ayton like a 7.5 or an 8 offer sheet. And the details of why it's not necessarily a 10 would be there was no player option on that offer sheet, which might have had Phoenix a little bit uncertain in wanting to match that. There was no trade kicker, is the phrase. Now, a trade kicker would mean if the Suns or Pacers were to trade Deandre Ayton within the course of that contract, that would add to the value that you would have to pay him a little bit earlier in the deal. And then another angle to it would be something called a salary advance. And that is kind of similar to the trade kicker. Obviously, it doesn't involve a trade, but the salary advance would mean you're guaranteeing more and more of that money up front for that player, thus restricting a win-now team like Phoenix to saying, oh man, we've got to pay him earlier in the deal. well, we might want some of that cap space to make other moves in case we need them at the trade deadline. So I say all this in thinking to myself, like, how much did the Pacers really want Deandre Ayton? If they really, 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 really wanted him, wouldn't they have thrown in some of that stuff?
Right.
Or did they look at it and say, yeah, we would take him, but we're not going to go, like, to the nth degree.
Yeah, the thing that's interesting about that, Kevin, is that...
And I don't... Sorry to interrupt, Jake. I don't want this to come off like I'm ripping the Pacers for it, because, again, I was anti-Deandre Ayton and paying him that much money. It's just interesting to think about what the Pacers' mindset and, you know, approach was with this. Of like, yeah, we would like him, but we're not going to, you know, roll out the red carpet from Phoenix to Indianapolis for him.
Here's the thing. There are two ways to look at it. The first is that the Pacers, because the player that this now puts kind of the microscope on would be Myles Turner, obviously, right? Because if you are Myles Turner, you're saying, wait a minute, they were willing to spend $133 million to upgrade over me? What does that mean for me? You know, so the Pacers basically, Kevin, it means one of two things. It means that the Pacers either think, number one, Myles Turner's been through this for like six straight years, and so we're not worried about how it emotionally affects him. He's entering the last year of his contract, and we are confident of his mental fortitude and maturity to block out the noise while he's in Tanzania on vacation, which he is, I think. So that's option one, is we're not worried about how Myles Turner will react to this. Option two is the thought of, listen, we know Myles Turner's gone, so we're not overly worried about how he's going to react to this news, because we're going to trade him at the deadline anyway. So let's go ahead and take a flyer to see and push in to see if we can get Ayton. And if they match, they match.
Ayton and Turner have the same agent.
And that's fascinating to me.
You read anything into that? Is this the Pacers helping out Deandre Ayton's agent? Therefore, Myles Turner would have been well informed about this, and he maybe doesn't have as much venom or bitterness how it seems.
Really good point.
A little bit of conspiracy hat.
Yeah, but I don't think that's over. I mean, I do think that some things like that do take. I think that sometimes you would be fascinated to know sometimes the simplicity in which things take place. Like, we assume that things are overly involved sometimes, and oftentimes it's more simple than that. You know what I mean?
Right. Duane Washington Jr., I believe, cleared waivers last night, so we'll have Scott Agness again on at 9 o'clock to talk more about
that. I thought
he
did a good job when his number was called.
Agreed. I'd like to see him back.
Agreed. When he gets hot,
yeah,
he's kind of a fun off the... He is a nice player if he's a guy that you're bringing in for... You know, Max Strus in Miami is this kind of a guy, like, that kind of played his way into a starting position, but...
He can microwave it up.
Correct. Speaking of microwaving it up, I brought back stuff from Canada. I forgot.
Sure.
I had brought mints from you guys from Roots, the blueberry and the maple mints.
I like those maple mints that you brought back. Was that at the Detroit race you went?
Correct. I went into Windsor and I went to Roots. This time I bought like six cans of mints. And I bought so many items of clothing that I think she forgot to put my mints in the bag, because I got back to my room and I'm like, where are my mints?
No.
I know.
Now, can you describe Roots for us?
Roots is a clothing store that is, they tried.
I've been to the food place here on Benford and
71st. Oh, yeah, it's wonderful too. That's Scott Wise's latest venture.
Yeah, it's great.
Great pint nights on Thursday night at the Roots.
They give you popcorn on your table before your food comes. Glorious.
Roots Clothing Store is a Canadian clothing store. That they opened one in Chicago and it just never took off. It is the greatest, not only quality of clothing, but just like, I'm telling you, they have the best clothes ever in terms of the quality of the clothing and just the coolness, if you will.
That's high praise.
I'm not kidding you, except for the t-shirts that you guys see me wearing of different colleges and sports teams, 60% of my wardrobe is from Roots in Canada. So it is a combination. I would say it's if Gap met Urban Outfitters, that's what you get in Roots.
Okay.
High quality clothing. And they make these little mints at the counter, little tins of mints, and I brought them back for you guys from Windsor, and then I bought literally Here's the thing. When you go to Canada right now, the dollar is like, it's like 74 cents or something. So, in other words, the American dollar is stronger, if you can believe that. So, if something is in Canada a dollar, it's actually 74 cents to us. So, everything's automatically 25% off. So, you walk in, you're like, well, hell, this is practically free. I mean, you're like
eyes just light up for an American.
You're like Kramer with his Japanese friends, right, Mark? You're just buying everything.
Take my credit card, and so, I'll think
now,
about it
you
later.
You are wearing the Peacock shirt. Was that because the race was on Peacock yesterday?
I thought about that, but no, I like the shirt, actually. And I thought, you know what, I haven't broken this out for a while. Thank you, Mark.
Oh, boy.
Now, here's the thing.
I can already see him from here.
I take notes on things, Kevin. I'm a thoughtful person, right? I brought back for you guys. I like how you laugh when I say that.
I like me some me.
I love me some me. That is true. The only thing I love more than me is ketchup potato chips.
Now, Mark, see the red bag from here.
If I'm not mistaken, Mark, you did or did not like the ketchup chips.
I thought they were all right. My wife loved them.
Okay, good. Well, your wife's going to be thrilled because I brought back for you a bag, once again, of the late. Here's the thing. I drove over with Michael Young, and I bought, an obscene amount of ketchup potato chips and had them in the trunk of Michael's car. And then I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to try to go ahead and get these back in my suitcase so that I don't have to then hook up with Michael, later today to get them. So I had them in my suitcase on the flight that I came back last night. But my bag was literally, spitting out bags of chips everywhere. I brought back, seven bags of chips. So, Mark, I brought you the Lay's, for your wife, I guess, the Lay's ketchup potato chips, not available in the United States. Now, the one thing I knew about you...
Will you flash those on the YouTube?
Oh, sorry. The one thing I knew, Kevin, is that you did not like Lay's. You apparently have a bias against Lay's potato
chips. Team Ruffles.
And so the Ruffles... You did or didn't like the Ruffles ketchup chips?
They started to grow on me. At first, it was like a 5.6, and by 10 o'clock, I swear it was a 7.7.
Well, this is a limited Hur Une, which I think means limited time only. But there's now a Doritos.
Whoa!
Ketchup-flavored Doritos.
Hot coffee. That's like the old school. Impressive.
That's the old school Doritos logo, too.
Look at that!
Mark looked impressed with that.
That was impressive.
That is a throwback.
So here you go.
Oh, my gosh.
You enjoy your breakfast.
Glorious.
There. Some ketchup-flavored Doritos.
That looks beautiful.
I'm telling you, they're good.
And, you know, I still have the mints in my car, and they've come in handy a few times.
They've come in handy after the Doritos ketchup.
They have.
Flavored, for sure. But there you go.
Well, thank you very much.
Nothing like the Rahals being now, wow, Jake, what all is in your suitcase?
Now,
well,
here's the thing.
I got chips in there.
I was so mad at myself, and let me tell you why. I went into a cigar store, and I was going to bring back, I had a couple of orders for Cubans. My buddy Jeff Sumter wanted a Romeo y Julieta. Other people were like, get a Boulevard. I went into a cigar store in Toronto, and all of the cigars they had, and I sold cigars for a long time, so I can spot a fake a mile away, right? I don't think their cigars were fake, but they rebanded all of them. So, the Boulevards had their own, house brand just with white type that was, Boulevard, Habana. Mm-hmm. I'm like, come on, man. And they wanted $65 a piece for them.
Yeesh.
Now, that's Canadian, 25% off, of course. So I bypassed the cigar deal.
Spotting a fake Rolex. You don't send that to Switzerland to get it clean.
That's right. Then I really wanted to get the rum. I wanted to bring back Cuban rum. I just thought that'd be cool. I was so tempted, and I'm like, you know what? The Rahals are kind enough to allow me to fly on their plane, and then we got to go through customs. I'm not going to put them in that position. And of course, what happens? But you guys got anything in your bag? No. All right, thanks. Boom.
I've been fortunate to fly private a couple of times, Jake, and boy, the old TSA, it's like the gif of the guy doing the pat-down.
Yeah, oh yeah.
In security, I forget where the
it's
event
a football
is.
Game, I
yeah,
think, yeah,
football. And, I mean, literally, just come on through. Yep, yeah. Yep, right
it's
here.
It's a different world, man.
It is certainly a different world. Thank you for said chips.
Yes, thank
I think
you.
You know, we had dinner last night and then dessert, and I was like, hey, Maddie, you want any... beaver nuggets, or I'm like, do you think I should just throw these away? I believe, you know, it kind of gotten to the point where it's like, all right, we've eaten over half the bag. Rosie would immediately, I think, have cavities all through her mouth if she tried to consume one of those. And Maddie looked at me like, do not throw those away.
Yeah. Mark, can you believe that would even be a consideration?
I can't even imagine.
Mark goes all the way, drove all the way to Kentucky to bring you back a gift, and you want to throw away 40% of it? What are you, the Canadian dollar?
All the way to Kentucky, yeah.
And then he had the gall to complain weeks earlier. I didn't get any. You going to throw them out?
He took his vacation to Bucky's, and Kevin's complaining of the souvenirs.
Somebody on Twitter is like, I just a gas station. I'm like, no one who's been there would call it just a gas
station. Just a gas station.
Get out of here with that slander.
Kyle in the YouTube chat goes, then why didn't the Phoenix Suns offer the Deandre Ayton max deal earlier? Took the Pacers offer for the Suns to move. Again, we'll double check this with Scott Agness in a bit, but I believe the Suns offer would have had to have been for 5 years, whereas the Pacers offered 4 and could match there. So I think some length had to do with that. But I guess overall, I'm just curious. Part of me thinks the Suns would have matched anything. Aren't they win now? Isn't Chris Paul 38 years old? Like, I have that feeling. But then I've heard this from a lot of people, you know, our equivalents in Phoenix, of like, if the Pacers would have made it more difficult to match, they think there would have been some pause from James Jones and Phoenix in matching that. Which is just kind of an interesting
thing. The thing that's crazy, think about this. Like, think about the cap space they have back now. You know what I mean? Not have back, but that they still have. I mean, they're in good position. The question is, can the Pacers find a way to spend it? Or do they, you know, what do they do moving forward?
And
right?
I've said this several times throughout the offseason, Jake, still get involved in that third team. Donovan Mitchell, Kevin Durant. You know, the offseason is still pretty young. I mean, we're only a month into it. So I still think you can do a whole lot. Things are going to quiet down, and obviously Summer League wrapped up. We should mention this before we get to a morning checkdown of Will Haskett joining us. I know Benedict Mathurin was great in the Summer League, played in the first 3 games. I don't know how much we put into this stock, but Aaron Nesmith was, I would say, poor in the 3 Summer League games.
Yeah, he did not play well.
Shot 27% from the floor, 25% from 3, averaged about 4 turnovers per game. And again, I don't think he practiced at all before joining the Summer League team. And every time you mention any sort of Summer League evaluation, you just throw in the caveat of, like, it is Summer League. But we have praised Benedict Mathurin, I think rightfully so. I thought Andrew Nembhard, Kendall Brown, the 2 second-round picks, showed some nice things as well at times. But Nesmith certainly struggled in his 3 games with the Pacers. All right, let's hit a morning checkdown here. Kevin.
The morning checkdown. Brought to you by QC Kinetics, relieving your joint pain at QCKinetics.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
I just want to be the best Jake that I can be.
Yes.
You brought us chips. There you go.
First day of school and they go around a circle. What do you want to be this year?
I just want to be the best Jake that I can be. Yeah, see? Nothing wrong with that, right?
Like, I want to be a fireman. Okay. Jake wants to be him.
Who are we betting on in the Home Run Derby tonight?
I got money on Schwarber.
Matt Stairs.
Matt Stairs. What a name. What a great lefty swing. I feel like he held the bat right up against his chest.
Who all's in it? I mean, obviously Pujols.
Pujols, Schwarber.
Pete Alonso, the favorite.
Pete Alonso, Juan Soto.
Acuna Jr.
Julio something from the Mariners. I forget who else.
It's like a recognizable field.
That is one of the things I like about Home Run Derby as opposed to like slam dunk contests, is they have actual names. Of course, we named like 4 out of 8, but still.
Hey, that's more than usual in baseball. Will you guys watch?
Yeah, I'll watch. Yeah. What else am I doing tonight? Pujols, Pete Alonso, Ronald Acuna Jr. from the Braves, Corey Seager from the Rangers, Julio Rodriguez from the Mariners.
Corey Seager back in his old ballpark.
Juan Soto of the Nationals, Jose Ramirez of the Guardians, and that's it.
I'm going with Juan Soto.
Okay. Any reason?
Yeah, Mario Soto was one of my favorite players when I was a kid. I don't think they're related, but I like the last name.
Kev?
No, I mean...
Now, Takuma Sato went out early in the race yesterday, right? No relation?
Did. Yeah, no, you are correct. No relation there, right?
Just want to clarify.
Just one vowel off.
So you've got Soto.
This is going to sound very weird. I would like to look up the dimensions of Dodgers ballpark. I would like to know if this favors a lefty or a righty. So maybe we'll do that a little bit later in the show. It's a Monday. I just don't want to start the week off losing money.
I can't pick a home run derby winner until I see the dimensions that I'm working with here.
I did salvage some money with Cameron Smith yesterday. Maybe we should move on to the British Open. When Cameron Smith double bogeyed the 13th on Saturday, I think a lot of people thought his tournament was over. I'm like, this is the time to pounce on great odds. threw 20 on it. Luckily, was able to salvage the weekend as Cameron Smith played pretty flawless golf from then on. And he shot 30 on the back nine yesterday. Cameron Young, the runner-up, and Rory McIlroy finishing in third place there. We'll see if that shows up on the pop quiz.
Yesterday in IndyCar, Scott Dixon, the win in Toronto, holding off Colton Herta, who was the pole sitter. As a result, Scott Dixon, his 52nd career win. That ties the great legend Mario Andretti for most wins in IndyCar history. Afterwards, Scott Dixon...
You were doing the transition thing. What do you want?
No. I was pointing at you like we're going to go to audio on, here. We need on. To have a meeting about
our
this.
Hand
I
signals are off. Look at the wrist.
When you point
we
down,
all have the wrist.
That usually
we
means hit the transition.
We
hit
all have
transition.
Our signals on our QB wrist.
This means people are watching on the YouTube. Does this mean let's go to sound? And then this means transition?
You've never waved at me in your life.
That first wave looked like one of those cheerleader spirit finger.
It looks like you just wanted like Miss Universe
mechanisms there.
Okay. Well, here is Scott Dixon yesterday talking about tying Mario Andretti.
Yeah, it means a lot. You know, I love Mario. I love Mario for so many reasons. You know, what he's done in the sport, what he's achieved, what he gives back to the sport. And you know, I keep saying, you know, I feel extremely lucky to have the likes of himself and AJ here most weekends, you know, and even to sit and chat with these guys. You know, their stories are obviously the generations that they raced in, or the generation and time that they raced in was a lot different from now. And you know, it means a lot to me, you know, to even be mentioned in the same conversation as these greats. You know, I never thought it was possible, you know. So
now he says, so Was there more?
Nope.
It should have cut off.
Leaves us hanging. I know. I didn't edit it. I don't know.
Jake, he has a long way to go to number one, right?
67 is the record, AJ Foyt. Yeah, a long way to go. Still. I was impressed, though, this morning, not by Scott Dixon, and totally relieved that I actually did get a good night's sleep, which was wonderful. But then I got up this morning on the way in. I parked and I checked my email, and there's the pop quiz from Kevin Bowen. Now, what time did you get up this morning? You must have had for breakfast beaver nuggets because you were an eager beaver this morning.
If he had his way, he'd thrown them out 3 days ago.
I was saying to you, I feel like the Monday pop quiz is pretty easy. And one of the questions on the pop quiz, and this is really going to test our listening audience to see how committed they are. This was something we talked about a few months back in reference to, I guess I'll just say it now. Who listens at 8:26 and 9:26 in reference to the Major League Baseball draft? Which I thought was just kind of an interesting storyline. When I saw it last night, I'm like, that's got to go on the pop quiz.
I did see that question, which was a good one.
Pop quiz, we have Zach Brown Band tickets. Pair of tickets. Yep.
Zach Brown Band at Klipsch. It is a terrific, terrific show. Colton Herta second. Felix Rosenquist third. Graham Rahal fourth. Marcus Ericsson fifth. Alex Palou, his drama-filled week, finishes with him moving through the field and getting sixth at Toronto. The Fever lose yesterday, 81-65 to the Seattle Storm. And again, the Pacers wrap up their summer league by losing to the Suns.
Alex Golden had tweeted and it blew me away because I know the Fever have been bad, but I didn't realize they were this bad. He said the last non-losing season for the Fever was in 2016 when they went 17-17. Since then, the Fever are combined 45-118.
That is really
just
bad.
Dreadful.
Yeah, I know right now it's like a 10-game losing streak.
Yeah.
I think one of them been by single digits.
Kevin, Mark, somebody asked on the on Twitter here if you're okay.
I'm fine.
What happened?
Occasionally. It was a long weekend. This house stuff is no joke.
90 minutes into it, and I feel like just not as crisp.
Really? I'm just starting to wake up. Have yourself some ketchup Doritos.
Will Haskett's going to join us next here. Kevin Aquari, 93.5, 107.5 The Fan.
Stay summer travel road ready at your Central Indiana Car X locations. AC inspection, $19.99. Lifetime brake pads, $109.99 per axle. It's Car X online for the location nearest you. CarX.com.
If you're a window installer, keep it simple. Choose Anderson 400 Series Windows. They're the clad wood windows contractors trust the most. So much so, they're the windows contractors trust for their own homes. And with fewer callbacks, the choice is simple. It's Anderson 400 Series Windows, the windows contractors trust the most. Get started at AndersonWindows.com today.
Claims based on 2022 Anderson Brand Survey of U.S. contractors. Hey, this is Lisa Stofan. Heard the Mark Patrick weight loss hypnosis hype? Well, I attended because my father stopped smoking with hypnosis. Hypnosis eliminated my desire for soda and fast food, made me want to exercise, and I lost 60 pounds in 6 months. My energy level exploded. I went to another session to deal with some other problem foods, and I lost another 10 pounds. In fact, I brought my husband. He lost weight. More important, cholesterol and blood pressure improved. My friend went, and she lost 20 pounds in the first 2 months. So does Mark Patrick hypnosis work? Oh yeah, it works. Nothing has changed my life more. Well, except maybe my husband. He's so proud of me. Makes me cry.
Join Mark Patrick seminars and lose the weight or stop smoking guaranteed for only $49.99. Hypnosis to destroy unwanted cravings. July 28th at the Hampton Inn and Suites in Fishers. Weight loss seminar 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 8 to 10 p.m. And Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn and Suites South in Indianapolis. Weight loss seminar 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Stop smoking seminar 2 to 4 p.m. Registration begins 30 minutes before seminar.
Circle K is America's thirst stop, and yours, especially when the weather gets and you need to stay refreshed on the go with ice cold Circle K favorites like freshly ground iced coffee, Froster, Polar Pop Cup, and more. Think of it as the ultimate thirst quenching, totally rehydrating summer splash zone. When life's go, 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 make us your first stop, because Circle K is America's thirst stop.
This is Claudia's O'Reilly Auto Parts story.
I had just moved to a new city and barely even knew where the grocery store was yet. When my car wouldn't start one morning, I didn't know who to ask about local shops. But I remembered a name from back home, O'Reilly Auto Parts. I called and they pointed me to a great mechanic just down the street. Now I feel a little more at home.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Rob Zombie, Mudvayne, Freaks on Parade Tour. Zombie, Mudvayne, together. This trip is for real. This Thursday night, Ruoff Music Center with Static X and Power Man 5000. Get tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. Zombie, Mudvayne, part of the Coors Light concert series.
It's time for camp. No, not that camp. We're talking Colts training camp.
Kevin Bowen here at Grand Park. Colts back to work.
So now we can ask the big questions.
Consistently much better this year.
The wide receiver core is a concern.
They would have liked to have seen some sort of veteran move there.
The Colts have just disregarded.
The NFL season countdown starts next Tuesday. It's Colts camp.
42 ISO, X Flash. I want
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
In the biggest upset in sports since Tyson was knocked out by Buster Douglas or the Miracle on Ice, Jack Floyd was upended in the British Open. And as a result, Kevin, a guy with a mullet won, right?
What did Jack shoot?
What did he, do we know?
Did he just miss the cut?
Here's the question. Jack Floyd, Tiger Woods.
Oh, I think Jack.
Mm-hmm.
Tiger. Jack Floyd was 10 over par.
That's not bad, right?
What was Tiger? I think Tiger might have been 9.
Let's find out. Let me scroll.
What a battle for 150.
Jack is a respectful young guy.
9 over.
Yeah, Jack's a respectful young guy, and he was like, look, Tiger's struggling. It's
walking across the bridge, kind of a sentimental moment there, all those things. Let's head to the Payless Liquors hotline, and Will Haskett from PGA Tour Radio joins us. Well, I mentioned this off the start of the show. You know, oftentimes you get 24 hours removed from any sporting event, or probably just any event. We often speak in hyperbole. I hope this is not that, but I think that back nine and just the final round in general from Cam Smith needs to go down as one of the greatest Sundays in a major ever. Is that speaking a little bit too much out of turn?
Yeah, no, absolutely epic. I mean, it was an epic week. I mean, it was a phenomenal tournament, the way you'd want to end the major season. And yeah, I think there was so much narrative around what a Rory win would have meant. And so all of the focus was on that final group and really on the final player. And so I hope that as we get away from it, the history books recognize what Cam Smith did. And it's been a phenomenal year for Cam Smith. So, you know, for him to win a major in addition to a players' championship is kind of fitting. Rory's probably had the best consistency year and isn't going to get a major out of it. And he kind of talked about it afterwards. But, yeah, I'm always a glass-half-full guy after these things because, again, it's really, really hard to win these golf tournaments. And so I hope that the history books celebrate it for what it was. And that's a guy that went out and won the golf tournament. I really don't think you can say that somebody gave that tournament away. I mean, outside of Victor Hovland, who played terrible. But, again, somebody in the final group was probably supposed to win that tournament. But what are you going to do with the 64 five straight birdies and the hottest putter on the planet? I mean, it just happens. And I hope that's how we always remember it.
When you look at okay, I want to go back to a couple of things here, Will, over the course of the British Open before we talk about like where it goes moving forward here. First off, aside from the obvious storyline, was there a player either in a positive or negative light, in other words, that either exceeded or fell short of your expectation that you felt like was one of the storylines that maybe we kind of slept on?
I mean, I don't really know about that. I mean, I think you had such, I mean, at one point in time on Saturday, you just turn on the TV, you're watching the run that both Rory and Victor were making together. You looked at that leaderboard in terms of star power, and it was everything you'd want out of a major. So I just think that the tournament delivered in so many ways, and I had a couple of discussions with folks early in the week because what Cameron Young did on Thursday, people were wondering, like, is this really what we want out of a British Open? And look, St. Andrews has always been the gettable golf course of the Rota. I don't care if it's new ball now in 2022 or if it was 40 years ago. It's big, wide fairways, and you know, if it's firm and fast like it was without a whole lot of defense from the weather, you're going to be able to score on that golf course. It's just always been the way that golf course is played in the modern game, and that's over the last 50, 60 years. And so I thought we had great drama. I think, look, I go back to Victor Hovland. He has not played good golf this year. This is a guy that people thought would contend in majors. And so for him to be relevant late in this tournament, I thought was a good sign for him. And I just wish that we had gotten a little bit more out of him yesterday instead of kind of going out with a whimper while everybody else was doing things around him. But no, I don't think there was anybody that was truly off the radar this week because everybody sort of had their moments to go and win it. It was Cameron Smith's tournament through 36 holes. And then all of a sudden it became the Rory show. And then Smith comes roaring back. So I think everybody kind of had their moment to shine, and there were probably six or seven characters that would have made for a really interesting story that could have won this golf tournament at some point in time over the weekend, and we ended up with, you know, Cameron Smith sort of validating this phenomenal season that he's been on.
I think I'd argue, Will, Cameron Young hanging in there for all 4 days. I mean, and what he shot on Sunday, it was a 65 yesterday, I think, from him as well. Like, I get that Cameron Young has had some moments, certainly the PGA Championship, but, you know, he has no British Open experience, and this is still a little bit new to him. Oftentimes, I think you see in majors a guy go out on Thursday and shoot some blistering score, and then he just naturally falls off the pace. You know, we're going to look at this in 10, 15 years. Everyone's going to assume Rory McIlroy was the runner-up, but Cameron Young was the guy that finished second.
He's got six top threes this year. I mean, he's done everything but win. I think to those of us that are inside the golf game, I think I passed the, is this for real from Cameron Young like 5 months ago? You know what I'm saying? But I think the people that only tune into the majors, it's like, whoa, what just happened here? Wasn't this the guy from the PGA Championship? Is this really real? Dude's got the goods. He was a phenomenal college player. And then he made a switch going into the Open Championship and put a veteran caddy on the bag in Chad Reynolds, who's was on the bag for Keegan Bradley for a long time and has been out on tour for a really long time. And just to have, you know, somebody with a ton of experience, I think it kind of showed this week. But it's really not that dissimilar to last year when Colin Morikawa, the week before, you know, shoots a million at the Scottish Open and then turns around the next week and wins the Open Championship. And again, Morikawa maybe slightly a step above Cameron Young in terms of talent, but it's not that far away. So he's going to win. His power was unbelievable on display. And again, I go back to the golf course. It was a perfect golf course for someone who can really drive the golf ball well. You know, Cameron Smith won it because he's the hottest putter and one of the best putters of his generation and on the planet. But that's a golf course that if you can really drive the golf ball beautifully, you can put yourself in position to do some crazy things. And look, Cameron Young doesn't have to answer to anybody anymore. Like, he's going to eventually win. And yesterday was a situation where he probably did everything he could to win that golf tournament, and it just didn't happen.
He's Will Haskett again from PGA Tour Radio, and he's with us here on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Well, I think oftentimes when you're in a position like Jake or I, and you're talking about a sport that might not be top of mind for our entire listening audience, you try to give a little bit of an analogy to more of a mainstream sport. With Rory yesterday, I felt like he was the football team that has the lead with 5 or 6 minutes to go, and he runs the ball on first down, he runs the ball on second down, and he runs the ball on third down, just hoping that the clock kind of runs out. He hit every green yesterday, he had some great looks at birdie, but I just felt like at times it wasn't a little bit more pedal to the metal that he needed, hoping that Cam Smith or Cam Young wouldn't shoot some blistering final round. Is that a fair representation of how you view Rory's final round yesterday?
Yeah, I don't know if I'd go like full comparison to say the Falcons a few years ago against the Patriots. I think Atlanta had as much blame in there as you would say the Patriots had in coming back in that Super Bowl, you know, in terms of, especially in this market, the pain that we had in having to watch that crap take place in the Super Bowl when all we wanted to do was see the Patriots lose. I think Sting sometimes in this market as much as anywhere else. I don't know if I go fully that far, and you're right. I think, could you be a little bit more aggressive? Could you have tried and taken on a couple of hole locations? Maybe. The plan had worked for him. And I come back, and I can't remember who the tweet was from, but one of the national writers put this out there. Rory McIlroy hit it one bunker the entire week. When he did, he holed it for eagle. That was on Saturday. He didn't make a bogey in the final round and shot two rounds of 66 and lost the Open Championship. So if you compartmentalize it that way, he did everything. But you're right. It's the reaction to, okay, he's leading the golf tournament. The guy he's playing with, who you kind of expected going into the day was going to be this sort of match play sort of vibe back and forth, never really musters up any sort of a charge to you. And so when you're getting to the back nine, you're like, okay, like I know I've got some scoreable holes here making the turn. I know that 18 is sort of gettable. I'm going to have to survive the road hole. Like I'm in contention to be able to do this. And then you all of a sudden have this flash up in front of you of Cameron Smith making all those birdies, and you have to maybe recalibrate a little bit. I don't know. It's a tough one for me, because if you had told me before the day started that Rory McIlroy wouldn't make a bogey,
right,
I'd say, oh, he's going to win the tournament.
And Hovland doesn't win.
Right. Like, I mean, he's going to win the tournament. Like, I mean, he shot 2 under par without making a bogey. Someone went out and shot 64, which up until a couple of years ago was, you know, the lowest round anybody had shot in an Open Championship. I mean, yeah, it's tough. It's really tough for me to look at it, but I will say this, and Rory's talked about this openly. Like, he's an alpha in skill, but he's not an alpha in personality. He knows it, and he's changed a little bit this year to be wildly more consistent to get to that sort of point. But those are the moments where alphas just find a way to wheel the ball in the hole when they need it on the back nine. It just didn't happen for Rory yesterday.
I want to – Will Haskett is our guest, by the way, from PGA Radio. Will, when it comes to Tiger Woods, and look, I know that at times it can probably be an exhausting topic, but, you know, listen, I know the respect that, in particular, both you guys, you and Kevin, have for Tiger Woods as a golfer. I know that his body has broken down, and I know of his age, and he's at the age where coming back from that becomes even more challenging, and he is a guy that has been driven by overcoming challenges. But did we see the beginning of the end here, or is this another hurdle that he will become hell-bent on overcoming and prove us wrong?
I mean, I think when that car tumbled down the hill, it was the beginning of the end. And what we've gotten in 2022 is probably more than any normal person would have ever given us. It's just kind of amazing to me that the major that we thought was going to be his best ended up being his worst this year that he played in. I mean, that to me was just kind of the weird thing of the year. Like, we didn't think he'd be ready enough to play at Augusta, let alone walk those hills on, you know, a cyborg leg that he's got held together by plates and pins, and somehow willed his way to making the cut, and then was in even more pain at the PGA Championship and still somehow found a way on a really hard golf course to make the cut. And then on what would be the easiest walk on a golf course where you would think that his mental strength would give him the best opportunity to win, you know, gets unlucky, first tee shot, ends up in a divot, makes a double, and then we were just sort of reeling ever since. And that was kind of the sad thing to me is that what we saw out of him this past week is, I think, what I expected to see out of him when he teed it up the first time this year. But because his sheer will gave us something that I don't even think any of us anticipated, then all of a sudden we set the bar probably unfairly a little bit higher. And he knows physically it's not going to be there. He's not walking away from the game at all, but I mean, it's going to be majors only, I'm guessing, for Tiger, and just trying to figure, well, and the father-son in December, you know, which is probably going to be his major now, trying to win that with Charlie. So I think that's kind of where we are right now, because he knows his reality physically, but he showed himself and he showed us that he can do it. So why not continue to sort of bask in these moments and try and get it up to be competitive in the next couple of years in majors?
Will LIV Golf, that will be at the forefront now of the golfing world, whether we like it or not, probably until the Masters. What is the next domino on that front in terms of a decision with the world golf rankings, player movement? We are done with the major season. There'll be the playoffs coming up here in, you know, late August, early September for the PGA Tour. There's a President's Cup, which is the U.S. versus the international team later in the year. But no major until the Masters next April. What is next on the LIV Golf decision-making front?
A lot of posturing. I mean, there's the report, and I don't know if it's fully official yet, but Henrik Stenson's going to join coming up here. I mean, he hasn't really been relevant for the last couple of years from a playing standpoint, but in doing so, he's probably going to forfeit his captaincy as the Ryder Cup captain next year, which is kind of a bold statement. And he's going to take the money and say, you know what, I'm valuing this money more than I am to be Ryder Cup captain. And that may actually change, because John Rahm came out yesterday and said, look, I'd like to have a Ryder Cup team that has my, you know, friend and mentor Sergio Garcia on it. So he's sort of now barking, like, let's try and find a way to come together, sing Kumbaya, and figure this whole thing out. And honestly, there was scuttlebutt yesterday that Cam Smith is probably maybe even going to make the jump as soon as this fall, with a reported maybe $90 million guaranteed offer on the table for him to be able to go over there. We're not going to see, I think, a lot of mainstream player movement in the next couple of months, because for those guys that are still on the PGA Tour, there's no sense in making the jump now when there aren't really live events worthy of jumping to, and you've got a giant pile of cash waiting for you in August with the FedEx Cup playoffs, the Comcast Business Tour Top 10, which rewards the top 10 guys in the standings at the end of the year. I mean, you know, you can win $20, $25 million playing golf on the PGA Tour if you're one of the top guys, and then make the jump and take your $7,500 million payout from LIV when it's all said and done. So, I mean, if you want, you know, go back to the obnoxious greed comment that was incredibly ironic and shameful, in my opinion, from Phil Mickelson talking about the PGA Tour before all these guys took this money. If you like obnoxious greed, the next couple of months might be for you.
Yeah, six straight major winners under the age of 30. That would be John Rahm, Colin Morikawa, Scottie Scheffler, Justin Thomas, Matthew Fitzpatrick, and Cam Smith. Right now, all six of those on the PGA Tour, but that non-answer from Cam Smith yesterday, which for those that missed it, basically was asked, are you, you know, have you thought about joining LIV? Are you going to join LIV? And he was like, that's not, you know, why are you asking me that right now? I'll let my team handle that. Oh boy, that did not sound good for someone like me wanting to see the tour stick together.
Yeah, and we're running out of time. I mean, we're running out of time for some of those guys to make decisions. But again, I think a lot of it will come after Labor Day when we get through the PGA Tour's season and it's over with, and we'll just kind of see where it goes. I mean, the only thing that probably benefits the tour at this point in time is the fact that it's a 48-man limited, you know, limited field. And I'll contend, like, you're not going to get the type of drama that you get out of majors or even some of the higher-level PGA Tour events like we had this weekend. And a big part of it has to do with the fact that when you tee off with 144, 156 guys, you just have the opportunity to have a lot of guys that are playing good golf. And with, you know, a whole bunch of guys in their 40s and early 50s on LIV, even if you get Cameron Smith and a couple of guys, like, you still could have a lot of duds. But at this point in time, I don't want it to seem like sour grapes. It is what it is. The sport is kind of split, and we're going to see what the domino effect of that is over the next couple of years.
Yeah, I don't see Cam Smith welling up at the Bangkok LIV event like he did yesterday after winning the British Open. He's been our man all major season long, Will Haskett, again, at Will Haskett on Twitter. Will, thanks so much for all your help this year.
We're on to the Twin Cities this week. Golf never ends. Thank you.
The 3M in Minneapolis this week, Will Haskett right there on the Payless Liquors hotline. That last point, Jake, I think is something that you can relate to a little bit, IndyCar cart split.
Totally.
We won't see Dustin Johnson and Rory McIlroy in the same field. I'm just pulling out two golfers there. We won't see them in the same field again until potentially the Masters in April. And that's what I hate.
Right.
I hate that there's a split and that you've got to go to two different avenues.
Yeah, and then it becomes confusing, Kevin. It just becomes confusing for people, like, well, which one is he in?
Right.
And, you know, what? Where are they golfing this week? You know, you talk about young major winners. Jack Floyd, I mean, he'll be the next on the mantle, right?
Oh, you imagine how much he's going to get from Liv? Right? After your endorsement of him?
Oh, I mean,
Saudis are knocking down his door right now.
Shorter university? I mean, that's a natural.
Now, for those that are trying to Google your guy, the spelling on the last name is a little different than what we're used to, correct?
No, Jack Floyd?
Double D, yeah.
Double D, right?
Not according to not what I'm looking at here. Let me see.
Oh, is boy. It? Multiple Jack Floyds here.
Have I been looking at the wrong Jack Floyd this whole time? I think I have.
Mark, you have the spelling?
Yeah,
F-L-Y-O-D-D.
Well, I've been looking at a different guy the whole time. The American kid that was the amateur that golfed.
Oh, it's a picture of Tommy Fleetwood. Whoops.
Well, yeah. Wait a minute. This Jack Floyd that you guys are talking about that was in it is a... Where's he from? Is this not the American Jack Floyd?
I believe Jack Floyd was from...
There's an American Jack Floyd that was in the PGA as an amateur.
In the PGA Championship?
Yeah, that golfed. He was like in the amateur championships from Shorter University.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say you're off on this one.
No. I get that, but I'm saying there is also, I'm looking right now at the bio of the American junior like champion, Jack Floyd from Savannah, Georgia, who was an amateur in one of the majors last year. That's the guy that I thought was
in the British
Open. I
found a Jack Floyd that is from Shorter University. Yes. But I don't see anything about him being on a tour of any sort.
Yeah, hold on.
Scott Agness will save us in 10 minutes.
Right here. He was in the Georgia Amateur PGA.
107.5, the fan.
Hey, it's Big Joe for your trusted local independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer, B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains. Co-owner Beth Rovazzini has 5 things to check before calling for an air conditioning repair.
Check your filter. Make sure that it's clean. Your outside unit's not plugged up. Your indoor coil isn't frozen up. Your condensate drain is flowing, and check your electrical connection. And then call the professionals.
BPlusW.com to schedule with those professionals from B&W Plumbing, Heating, Cooling, and Drains, your trusted local independent American Standard heating and air conditioning dealer.
This is Matt Crowder live at the gas station on 41st Street reporting on those skyrocketing gas prices. Excuse me, miss. Are you buying less gas now because of the high prices?
Oh, I never pay full price for gas anymore. I just use the free Upside app that pays you cash back for every gallon of gas you buy.
Wait a minute. Are you saying you actually get paid cash when you buy gas with the Upside app?
Yes, I get real cash back every time I buy gas.
Well, does that actually add up to anything?
I've made around $200.
Wow. Well, there you have it. Stop paying full price for gas. Download the free Upside app and get real cash back every time you buy gas. This is Matt Crowder Radio News Network. Download the free Upside app now to earn real cash back every time you buy gas. Use promo code BUS for a $5 bonus on your first tank. You can cash out anytime right to your bank, to PayPal, or any gift card for Amazon and other brands. Just download the free Upside app and use promo code BUS for a $5 bonus on your first tank. That's code BUS.
Hi, I'm Ryan Kelly with thehomeloanexpert.com. The amount of money our clients receive with a simple cash-out refinance is life-changing. Imagine paying off all your credit cards, completing home improvement projects, and taking the family on a much-needed vacation while still having money in the bank. And with our 10-day closing guarantee, that could all be a reality quicker than you think. Your home is probably worth more than ever before. Learn more and get pre-approved at thehomeloanexpert.com. The Home Loan Expert LLC, NMLS number 1326241.
You want to feel important. You want to be a part of something bigger, something that matters and can help change things. You want to feel like you belong. We know. We felt that way too. And that's why we did something about it. We aren't just Army National Guard soldiers. We are normal people just like you. And together, we can make a difference. Take on your legacy. Visit NationalGuard.com to find out more.
Sponsored by the Indiana Army National Guard. Aired by the Indiana Broadcasters Association and this station.
My name is Kayla Sinders, and I work for Gleaners Food Bank. I am a local service manager for 3 counties in our 21-county service area, and I nominated Katie.
And I'm Jiffy Lube owner Steve Sanner. At Jiffy Lube, we are proud to support Hoosier charities that use their vehicles to do more to make Indiana a better place to live.
My name is Katie Wilkerson. I pick up at the mobile food pantries. The best part of volunteering to hand someone some food and see the smile on their face, the relief. Without my vehicle, there's no way I'd be able to do this. To go to any of the pantries, it's at least 18 miles.
Jiffy Lube of Indiana provides all of our Do More winners with free vehicle maintenance for a year. Because now at Jiffy Lube, our trained technicians do more to keep vehicles like theirs and yours on the road. Brakes, tires, batteries, and more. As well as Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
Jiffy Lube accepts competitors' coupons, so you don't have to choose between saving a few dollars versus treating your vehicle to Jiffy Lube's award-winning service. Click on JiffyLubeIndiana.com for a Jiffy Lube near you.
Hey, it's Monday. I am at the 17th hole hitting shots and doing shots at Golf Club of Indiana. Jimmy's taking over. Show is better. I'll join it today.
And that's why they call me.
Listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Here's my random serendipitous brush with greatness at the IndyCar race over the weekend. You ready?
Okay. Who was the Canadian that did Start Your Engines? I assume it was Canadian, I guess.
I didn't hear the Start Your Engines. Was it good or bad?
I did not hear. I caught it like... car's already on the track when I dialed up Peacock.
At Mid-Ohio.
Start Your Engines, eh?
At Mid-Ohio, the Start Your Engines was the tight end from Ohio State. He was like...
I thought that was a bit obscure.
Yeah, and he was like, all right, guys, turn the key. It was like, what's going on
he
here?
He looked like he wanted to almost get like hit by one of those cars. Yeah. Like, I'm going to show my toughness.
Totally. Davey Hamilton, who does the radio network with us, he is the driver analyst for IndyCar Radio. I'm talking to Davey Hamilton, and Davey also runs a hospitality tent for Ed Carpenter Racing. And this name will not mean as much to you guys, I realize, but we're talking on Saturday, and he goes, hey, you remember Willie Aames? And I'm like, Willie Aames from Eight is Enough and Charles in Charge? He's like, yeah, who was a massive star of the 80s, late 70s, early 80s. He said, yeah, he's in our tent, our hospitality tent this weekend. I'm like, wait, what? What is Willie Aames doing at the IndyCar race? And Davey said, well, I didn't know who he was. My wife knew who he was, but I didn't know who he was. But he is working for one of the sponsors for Ed Carpenter Racing. BitNile is the company that he's now involved with. And they're a sponsor, and so he's been coming to the races. And I'm like, you're kidding me. And Davey said, no, stop by the tent. He's a super nice guy. So I walk over yesterday during lunch in the hospitality tent that Davey Hamilton runs, and there's this guy sitting there eating. And so Davey walks me right over to him and says, hey, you know, Willie, I want you to meet my coworker on the radio network. This is Jake. Whatever. Hey, man, how are you? Like, this guy. So I said, hey, I got a weird question for you. He goes, oh, yeah, man, absolutely. I'll answer anything. Hey, pull up a seat. So I sat there. We probably talked for 30 minutes. Could not have been a nicer guy. And the question I asked him, and this is really weird. You guys tell me if this is a weird question, but I've always been fascinated by this. Television shows like Eight is Enough or Charles in Charge. He also, as a little kid, he was on Gunsmoke. I mean, he was in a lot of different things in the 80s, 70s and 80s, all the way back to the 60s. But I was like, if you're flipping the channels and one of the shows that you were on comes on, like, do you remember filming it? Like, as you're watching the scene, do you remember exactly what was going on? As you're looking at the screen, do you see, like, the set and you only remember it as, like, the bits and pieces that you filmed? And he said, he goes, you know, actually some of them, yes. He's like he said, it really came back to me when I watched the movie Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, because they had the fictional Western movie that was taking place and a little kid that was on it. And he goes, it instantly like brought back all these memories that of being on the set of Gunsmoke when I was a little kid that I'd kind of forgotten about. And he said, but I do see most of those. I remember the filming of them. Very specifically, other things I see, and I'm like, I have no recollection of when we did that. No recollection of filming it, nothing.
Yeah, I would think like the bits and pieces, but not the...
Yeah, I mean, it's been 40 years, right?
Is there even a fluidity to it?
Right.
Yeah, I was thinking about that. We wrapped up season one of Ozark last night, and I'm just like... I'm fascinated to learn more about just like how long the filming is, and are you doing all the seasons in a X amount of week, month period... are you filming some parts of season three right after you're filming some of them in season one just for, like, the logistical aspect to it?
I asked once. I remember asking a Hollywood actress once, and they said that they don't film movies in sequence. They just film. They do a. You know, they might film like the last scene for, you know, whatever. Now you're done with Ozark season one. You're giving it what grade so far?
I'd give it a solid B to a B plus.
Okay.
Yeah, we actually just watched episode one of season two last night.
Okay.
Now season four, I was told in multiple parts. There's like a part one and a part two.
Yeah, they split it into two parts.
Yeah,
I think it's like 7 and 7.
Yeah, so far.
I mean, what difference does that make when you just binge watch it?
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
Yeah, I know. I was a little bit confused by
that. It was like my parents. They watch Better Call Saul too, and since their accent, they're behind. You know, their DVR was filled up, so they're catching up on episodes. And then we didn't realize that it's Better Call Saul. We started their second part last Monday, and we're like, oh, so we stayed up and watched it. Like, oh, yeah, we watched it. We knew it was coming on. I'm like, well, you'd have a three-month break from it. You got to move right into it.
You know, my DVR is completely full. It's at capacity now.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, Hoarders is the show that's all on there.
That's a problem.
Now, the at capacity, that was Zach Brown.
That's no capacity.
No capacity.
He can't do an interview because he has no capacity.
The head of McLaren this weekend?
I did not see him this weekend, but I was going to ask him how the no capacity was going, but I didn't see him.
He's Jake Query. I'm Kevin Bowen. Mark Dykton, as always, when we come back, Scott Agness, he's been busy at Pacers Summer League. Could Indiana have sweetened that Deandre Ayton offer sheet? We'll chat about that next with Scott here on 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
The Ride with JMV.
Deandre Ayton has agreed to a four-year, $133 million offer sheet with the Pacers. The largest offer sheet in NBA history. This is eye-popping. The Pacers have been careful in the past for a reason. Maybe this is just like opening up the checkbook for real now. Clearly, they just really like the player. Clearly, they believe in the fit.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays, 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
And we're back at our Night in the Fan Cave event, talking with listener Charlie, who had dialed up QC Kinetics and was getting back on track and in a much better state with his pain. It was knee pain for Charlie. And if you've got pain, hip, shoulder, any sort of joint pain, QC Kinetics can help you out. They are the nation's leader in regenerative medicine. They've got locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. We're talking natural alternatives that can give you lasting relief using your body's own healing power. Listen, steroid shots are toxic to your joint pains. You know pain meds are addictive, and nobody wants to go under the knife. So you can get help with QC Kinetics, regenerative protocols that can address any pain in any joint and give you the quality of life that you deserve with no drugs, no downtime, and no surgery. So call QC Kinetics today and schedule a free consultation. That is 463-235-7160. Again, locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. QC Kinetics at 463-235-7160.
Hey, it's JMV here for John and Chris Love. That's Love Heating and Air, 317-353-2141. I would not trust anybody else with my cool and comfort in-house and making sure that my system is running efficiently. If you feel as if yours isn't, 353-2141. Get that checkup from John and Chris Love at Love Heating and Air, making sure it doesn't cost you money and you remain cool and comfortable. Love Heating and Air, 317-353-2141 online. Love-HVAC.com today.
Rob Zombie, Mudvayne, Freaks on Parade Tour. Zombie, Mudvayne, together. This trip is for real. This Thursday night, Ruoff Music Center with Static X and Power Man 5000. Get tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. Zombie, Mudvayne, part of the Coors Light concert series.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The NTT IndyCar Series is at Iowa Speedway for a doubleheader. Race 1, Saturday at 3:30 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Marcus, is YouTube off? Someone was saying that my camera's out of...
No, your camera might have come undone.
Gosh, it's a tough Monday for me.
I'll have to fix you.
We'll have to fix you. Boy, that's just a Nice statement you want to hear.
Have some Doritos ketchup chips. That'll help you
on
out.
A Monday morning. Yes, thank you to Jake for his gifts from north of the border that he has brought back. I'm a guy that is, I believe, back in Indianapolis. He's been a busy man over the past week or so. Usually joins us on Thursdays, but with him out at the Vegas Summer League, we decided to postpone that to Monday. Scott Agness from Fieldhouse Files with us. Scott, have you recovered from a week in Vegas?
Not yet, no. Between the time that you're out there and thrown off and late nights and then the time change. But I will say it's really nice late at night when you're out in Vegas. And Twitter becomes silent, which allows you to enjoy your peace of mind of where you are, I think, a little bit more, at least for me, while I'm out there. But Vegas, I'm sure, as you discussed, is very much, I would assume, what the NFL Combine's like, which is just a big media and league convention where everybody's there, and it's easily my favorite event of the year.
Scott, for the Summer League for the Pacers, I want you to give me two names. One is the player that you feel like most helped himself, and one is the player that left the most head-scratching.
Yeah, I think the player that was the most head-scratching a little bit was Duane Washington Jr. Just felt like he was pressing the entire time. He did have a little bit different role off the bench than a starter, then off the role, then off the bench again. So he was the one that was a little bit questionable. Some might say Aaron Nesmith is shooting, but, I mean, he was just thrown into the mix like a week ago. Didn't go through one practice. Was playing golf when he found out about the trade. So I kind of excuse his situation. And then I'd say the guy that probably helped his case was rookie David DeLeo. He was a guy that was one of the standout non-Pacers in many camps. He was the guy Ronald Nor had said, hey, keep an eye on him. And I thought he played fairly well for being a guy that was, you know, 12th or 13th off the bench.
Now, with Duane Washington Jr., Scott, has he cleared waivers? What's the latest on him as a free agent if he could be back here?
Yeah, so nobody has picked him up. That was Thursday night? And so he would have cleared waivers. So that then becomes a possibility here. But the other thing I keep in mind, though, is they just got added Aaron Nesmith, who plays a very similar position. And so you got to consider roster numbers, and do you want to have so many guards in that backcourt? So I don't see it as a sure thing one way or the other of whether he's brought back or not. But no, to this juncture, has not been picked up yet.
Scott Agness is with us again, Fieldhouse Files, and he's on the Payless Liquors hotline. Scott, I brought this up a little bit earlier. I went on and actually was texting a little bit back and forth with you yesterday about it. Went on Phoenix Radio on Friday, and they were a bit surprised that the Pacers, you know, didn't, I guess, throw anything else into that offer sheet for Deandre Ayton that would have made Phoenix pause. They looked at it and they thought it was a very basic offer sheet, and the Suns matched it extremely quickly. Do you think that is an indicator of maybe the Pacers liked Deandre Ayton but didn't love the idea, didn't empty the treasure chest, if you will, in making that offer sheet a little bit more difficult for Phoenix to sign?
Yeah, so that's an interesting thought as well. I had it myself because I was looking into it, and I was like, all right, what's the deal? Specifically, because what came to mind for me personally in this situation was Gordon Hayward. Utah wouldn't offer him a max deal. So he went out. First, it was going to be Cleveland, but then LeBron went back to Cleveland. So then it became Charlotte. Charlotte offered him a deal. It was not a 4 years straight up. It was 3+1, meaning 3 years plus a player option. Well, that's what ultimately led Gordon signed that. Then Utah matched it. Not only did Gordon only stay there for those 3 years, opt out, go to Boston. But he was there 2 years shorter than he could have been if Utah would have signed him to a max deal. So I was like, all right, what's the deal here with Ayton? And as I found out, no options, meaning no player option, no team option. It was fully guaranteed, and it did not include a trade kicker, nothing whatsoever. So it was just a straight-up four-year deal. Now, the thing you have to keep in mind, too, is he's got to be willing to sign it. So you couldn't just throw a team option in there in year four because DeAndre probably would not have signed that, right? So it's not completely as straightforward as you'd think with this offer sheet. However, I do wonder, for example, like a trade kicker. I think any player would want a trade kicker, and there you get paid.
Can you explain what that is?
Yeah, so that would be a situation where if a player was dealt, then he would get usually 10%, maybe 15% of their annual salary. They would get that as like a bonus for being traded, and it is paid by your outgoing team. And that's one way to say, hey, you pick this situation. It's what you wanted. However, if the team makes a business decision to move on from you, at least you're compensated a little bit financially for having your situation completely changed.
Scott Agness is our guest from Fieldhouse Files. Scott, there were some other players, I don't know how much you saw non-Pacer games, but there were players with Indiana ties that were playing in the summer league, either, players from the area or college players. Sasha Stefanovic, for example, for San Antonio. Did you get a chance to see any of those guys play?
You see a little bit. It's funny. There's even some media members, Jake, that go out there and don't even go to games or go to the games but don't watch them. Because, again, it's all about the people, the relationships, that type of thing. That's the bigger event here than just the summer league games. So I caught some of them. I caught some of Jaden Ivey's first game. Travion Williams had a very good second game I was at. But also for me personally, it's also about writing about the Pacers. So I would maybe sit at games, casually watch, but be on my laptop writing my next story. So none of them I specifically just sat there, watched, and enjoyed because there was a better use of my time. But there were plenty of options out there.
Do you hear any, Scott, part of why I ask, one of the guys mm-hmm. that's a fascinating story to me because there was so much hype about him, and I know that health has been an issue, but now that he's in San Antonio, I was a little surprised Romeo Langford was not on the Spurs Summer League team. At least I don't think he was. He's only played in 90 games or so over the course of three seasons. Health has been an issue, but when he's gotten in, he's just kind of been there. He has yet to really take off in an NBA standpoint. Do you hear anything at all about Romeo Langford? And is this a guy that we may be looking at, in a couple of years that is like in a summer league or a G League trying to find his way back into the NBA? Or do you think he's firmly entrenched in the NBA?
Yeah, that's honestly a name I have not heard about probably since February, since the trade deadline and all of that. So that's how little to non-existent I heard about him or was discussed. Now, I forget the exact rule. I want to say it's after 2 years, a player has to be willing to go and play in summer league. They can't just, a team cannot just assign it. It's very much like G League, I believe, where you must. That's why TJ Leaf, in year four, his last one here, it was year three. He was like, no, I decline. I do not want to go and play in the G League. So that has to be agreed upon within the player. Now, yeah, you're right. Maybe it would have benefited him to go there and play a couple of games under the Spurs system, be out there with the guys. There is that little bit of a thought, though. I know for an individual, I was a first-round pick. I was not just that. I was a lottery pick. I'm bigger and better than this. Would this, devalue what I am, or is this kind of a punch in the gut here? So that could be something as well. The other thing is here is we're looking upon the Spurs going to have a lot of playing time. The Spurs are very much rebuilding, and especially after moving on from DeJounte Murray. So maybe he should have that real opportunity this upcoming season, which will be his final year under his rookie contract.
Did seem like Blake Wesley from Notre Dame had some nice moments in summer league for the Spurs. That was a first-round pick for them this year. Scott Agness, again, is with us here on Kevin and Query. Scott, Myles Turner, I'd say pretty well. Obviously, your long time on the beat speaks for itself. How do you think Myles has reacted to all of this Deandre Ayton stuff, and do you think the fact that they're represented by the same agent maybe lessens a little bit of, I think, how at least I or a lot of people view how Myles would react to it?
Yeah, I think it lessens it in that his agent can prepare him for this moment. Be like, hey, look, I have a competitive client here, and the Pacers are going to offer him a deal. He can really clue him in on the Pacers thinking and everything behind it. However, there's a lot of basketball people out in Vegas that were like, all right, this is a really tricky situation for the agent. He's probably going to lose one of these clients by the end of the summer, by however this shakes out. So The other thing, again, this is very probably inside baseball a little bit here, but Myles changed agents after he signed this current deal that, you know, paid him, what, $85 million, meaning this current agent hadn't got a cut of this current deal. And so if he was moved on before the next deal, he wouldn't get any cut of that either. So it's really interesting to follow there. He was down in Tanzania. He did have his best friend there with him this whole time. I think he knew something was probably coming. I think he probably did follow from afar on Instagram, because several times he would post that he was like in a Zen spot, no noise, or, you know, he's quieting things out, which basically said, I see it, I hear it. All right, I'm going to use this as motivation. That's at least how I read into it. I don't think it's any sure thing that, you know, okay, you missed out on Ayton, and now Myles will be too disgruntled to come back. None of that, I don't think at all, because remember, he has so much motivation to have a strong year. First of all, he needs to be healthy. He needs to finish a year healthy, and he's in a contract year. So I'd say both sides really need each other approaching this upcoming year.
Scott, do you believe that Myles Turner, in terms of his mental approach, in hearing his, you know, in terms of how he reacts to this kind of noise, at this point, do you think he's veteran enough that he really, it doesn't bother him? Or is he a guy that is more thin-skinned and susceptible to fall to those pressures than other players?
I wouldn't say it doesn't bother him, because even just him posting no noise tells me it bothers him. However, I think now we're going on the, third offseason where he has been significantly named and rumored. That for that alone, I think he's probably used to it a little bit. Ever since the potential trade with Gordon Hayward, that was the real first time that he was truly offered, and it looked like it could have happened. Everything else, I think, before that was very much just rumored. But after that first year, he talked about, hey, man, I'm used to this. Like, this is nothing new. Half the fan base kind of wants me out. Half the fan base loves me, embraces me as part of my, you know, fan section. So I think it's a little bit of a hit on his ego, on his pride, on his loyalty to the franchise, but he also gets it's part of the business now.
Scott, where's the dilemma with Myles this coming season, assuming he is still a Pacer, and you'll want to play him to improve his trade value, but if you firmly believe he doesn't want to be here long term and he's going to walk in free agency next summer, why would you play him a lot of minutes, therefore stunning the growth of Isaiah Jackson, Goga, you know, whoever else you want to throw into that group?
I've got no indication that he does not want to be here, for one. The number one motivating factor is to understand truly what he is under Rick Carlisle's offense without Sabonis and being more of the featured guy. And obviously either one, you want him really help and aid the team. He's one of the few veterans on the roster anymore. And then secondly, he's not part of this group moving forward, you want for him to maximize his trade value over the first couple of months and then move on from him at the trade deadline. Otherwise, you risk losing him for nothing. Now, you could swing a sign-and-trade type deal, very similar to what they swung with Malcolm Brogdon with Milwaukee when the Bucks really had no interest in paying Brogdon what he got paid, and they had just paid Eric Bledsoe and all of that. So I think they need to have, one, a firm understanding of his health, how he's doing, how he looks with this group. And also both sides have to have a clear understanding of what their end game is here. And the Pacers, are they willing to, how much money would they be willing to commit moving forward to Myles? And that's a huge question, considering, like you said, the bigs behind them. Behind Myles, and do you want to continue on with their relationship for many more years, or let's go ahead and make that transition, go much younger, and get that more playing time for those guys? But I don't think the other guys are quite ready just yet for more full-time roles.
So you believe both parties, Myles and the Pacers, still think there could be something long-term here?
I do, yeah. I mean, I wouldn't say either side is even close to considering something. But, yeah, I was asked on a podcast last week, I think it was, like, Myles is ready to leave, right? And I'm like, wait, no. What? He hasn't given that indication at all. I think both sides respect what they do for one another. The number one thing, honestly, has just been Myles' availability, how he's been available for 47 and then 42 games the last couple of years. For that reason alone, should it continue, the Pacers will have to move on. Like, you cannot – I think they've done a great job, the front office this summer, of moving on from the health-concerned guys. And that they got to put those issues in the past. And Myles, I would include in that group over the last 2 years.
Fieldhouse Files is where you can read Scott Agness's work. That's when you are not hearing him on this show opining and sharing his information about the Pacers. Scott, appreciate it as always.
All right, thank you guys.
I got to tell you, I am still just incredulous over the fact that I've been rooting for the wrong Jack Floyd.
Yeah, that's a tough realization.
That's an error on your part, though.
Excuse me?
It's an error on your part.
It's a very understandable error. Because
was spelling the big hindrance for you?
No. Here's the thing. The Jack Floyd that I thought we were talking about is the 2019 Player of the Year of the amateur PGA.
What is the amateur PGA?
Well, thank you for asking. The GA in this case is the abbreviation for Georgia. So it's not the PGA that I thought. It's a smaller circuit of the state of Georgia, georgiapga.com. But when you first mentioned Jack Floyd, and I looked it up, and I'm like, oh, because don't they, Kevin, in these tournaments, don't they oftentimes have amateurs?
Yes, yeah. You probably had a handful of amateurs playing. And basically, amateur is another term for college or high school.
Yeah,
golfer.
So he is a college golfer in Georgia who had participated in the PGA, which stands the people of Georgia. So I got thrown off by that.
So you thought the people of Georgia was the PGA Tour
the
PGA Championship.
Listen, smarty pants. If you Google Jack Floyd golf, the first thing that comes up, Georgia PGA. And then it says age 17, results, PGA. I'm like, okay.
But does he spell it
yeah,
like
I was gonna say, if
normally?
If you spell it correctly. Then
like
Michael
Floyd from Notre Dame.
Hold on. The Jack Floyd the golfer. What percent of people know that Jack Floyd the golfer has two D's in his last name?
I didn't know until I saw the British Open guy.
Correct. So what I'm saying is when we were going over, this all began when we began talking about the odds, right, that you could place. And I believe it was, Mark, you simply said, Jack Floyd is like 15,000 to 1. And I go, there's my guy. And so I Googled Jack Floyd. Now, obviously, I just put it, and as I'm Googling Jack Floyd, before I got to the opportunity to put the second D in Floyd, it comes up, Jack Floyd Golf. I'm like, oh, this must be the guy he was talking about. And the first thing that comes up, Jack Floyd tournament results, Georgia PGA, 17-year-old amateur. I'm like, wow, this is impressive. That's my guy.
Good news if you've made it this far, just 10 more minutes until Zach Brown.
I think it's a fairly understandable snafu, is it not?
Who's got more airtime, Jack Floyd from Georgia or Fanboy Zhang?
I mean, you talk about the NIL deals. I'm shocked you haven't brought up Fanboy Shoes from last night.
Jack Floyd, by the way, he placed well in the Hurricane Junior Golf Tour last year. Good grief. I'm just saying.
It's a pair of tickets to see the Zach Brown Band. That is Thursday, July 28th at Ruoff Music Center. We are giving that away all week long, right, Mark?
All week.
Pop quiz.
Or as long as we're on the air. Yeah, I don't know if we're going to keep talking Jack Floyd.
Probably a better way to preface it.
Right.
Yeah, thank you for that, Mark. It is time for a morning checkdown.
The Morning Checkdown. Brought to you by QC Kinetics, relieving your joint pain at QCKinetics.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Summer League has come to an end, and that means perhaps, at least for now, the tenure as a Pacer for Fanboy Zhang. Yesterday, it was Phoenix all over the Pacers in Summer League. As a matter of fact, nobody in double digits, right?
Yeah, no one scored in double digits for the Pacers. Again, they're resting a bunch of guys here late in Summer League. Here was Head Cat resting. Yeah,
why are you resting? What else are you doing?
that is a very good point. Here was head coach of the Summer League, Ronald Norred, on his takeaways from the five games in Vegas.
I got a lot of them. I think, number one, the group. It was such a great group to coach, to be around, to work with. That's the biggest one. We had a lot of fun over the 2 weeks that we were together. And I think we learned a lot as a staff. You know, hopefully there's some things that we did that we can apply to the season. And, you know, ultimately we wanted our guys to learn and get better, and I think we did that.
Four games my max. I can't do five. I know I got the next 4 months off. I got
a long flight back to China. I got to rest.
Now, this is like, we're now going to get to quiet time in the NBA. These are where no summer league, no training camp stuff, no practices, nothing until September. So obviously you'll have some, you know, roster moves and still some things to happen. But this is where the on-court aspect of it gets very crazy. Jake, the British Open, the winner is Cam Smith, 64 yesterday, a 30 on the back nine. He birdied 10, 11, 12, 13, and 14. Something we've talked a little bit about on the show, but it was pretty impressive. The crowd, 98% want Rory to win. There were some great shots NBC had of like little kids, fingers crossed at Rory's shots. And here's Cam Smith, just, you know, ho-hum, even-keel temperament, making five straight birdies to start the back nine and ruining what so many people thought was going to be a Hollywood story for Rory.
How about afterwards when he said, I don't know how many beers fit in this trophy, but I'm gonna, or this cup, but I'm going to find out.
Yeah, the old claret jug, he's going to throw, that's I'm
Foster's.
Sure
he, you know, that's Australian.
Threw back a few. He was drinking in the scoring tent, it looked like, hopefully after he signed a scorecard, but he just had one of those beer cans that just said beer on it.
That's the best. Like Mama's Family, that's what they used to have in TV, low-rent TV shows. They would just have the white can that just says beer.
Now, someone was saying, you know, guys with mullets tend to do well there. John Daly won there, and now Cam Smith. Do you think we'll see more golfers adopt the mullet when they go back to St. Andrews?
Jack Floyd. As soon as he's old enough to grow his hair out, I guess.
We have Will Haskett on tomorrow to talk Jack Floyd.
Which one are we talking about?
We had him on. We should have asked him. So what do you know about Jack Floyd 1D or 2? Either one. Tell us.
Major League Baseball yesterday, Yankees over the Bo Sox 13-3. It was Tampa over Cute Fella 7-5. White Sox blanking the Twins 11-0. Cubs over the Mets 3-2. Pirates over Colorado 8-3. And the Reds and Cards were rained out. Postponed yesterday.
Good. Good, good, good. What else we got? Fever loss yesterday. Jake, you were north of the border for the Honda. What was the official title? Honda?
Honda Indy
300,
Toronto
200,
is what it's called. Honda Indy 300, I think is what it's called. Scott Dixon, the winner. He has now tied Mario Andretti second all-time in the career IndyCar wins list. A.J. Foyt with 67 is the all-time career leader in that category. Colton Herta of the pole sitter finishing in second.
And you've mentioned this before. This is when Scott Dixon usually can get a bit hot.
Yeah, and in particular now when you go back-to-back-to-back, right? So next weekend is Iowa, then you go from Iowa to...
And that's a doubleheader this weekend, right?
Correct. Then you go from that to here on the road course at IMS, and then straight from that to Nashville. In terms of getting in those rhythms, man, that's when Scott Dixon can really start to get things going.
Marcus Ericsson up 35 points on Will Power, 37 on Alex Palou, and then Joseph Newgarden and Scott Dixon 44 points behind, so... If Marcus Ericsson's going to win this season series in points, he's going to have to hold off some pretty big hitters without Alex Palou finishing sixth after his eventful week with Chip Ganassi and a little bit of Errol McLaren as well. All right, what'd you think of my version of the pop quiz?
Not bad. Pretty doable, but you know what? In all honesty...
Super present-day relevant.
I think. And like nothing against, obviously, Scotty at all, but probably a little more in the mainstream.
Are you saying there's no 1932? The stepfather of Whitey Ford managed for the Brooklyn Dodgers.
I'll put it to you this way. Your entire pop quiz is the length, typically, of question number two. You know what I mean?
No offense, Scotty. We do love his perspective and his deep knowledge with the pop quiz. But yes, it is a little bit more mainstream, a little bit more relevant. And again... Zach Brown, a pair of tickets to see the Zach Brown Band next Thursday at Ruoff is up for grabs. 317-239-1070. It's pop quiz time next.
The Mower Shop in Fishers featuring Spartan Mowers. They have the perfect mower to fit any yard, any size, any time. TheMowershop.com and 317-849-9500.
We want to have a party at your house with your friends this summer. Go to 1075thefan.com/contest to enter to win a Kinetico Backyard Bourbon broadcast in your backyard with JMV.
You need a lawn care pro and a pest control pro. You can have both in one guy, you. DoMyOwn.com will help you get there with pro products, pro knowledge, and pro support. DoMyOwn.com for the pro and you.
Mom, Dad, I humbly suggest you save some money and shop Amazon for back to school. It's for my growth. Meaning my body's growing at an alarming rate. And clothes you buy me this year will be very small very soon. Plus, the clothes I love today will be out of style tomorrow. But at least your wallet doesn't have to be my fashion victim if you shop low prices for school at Amazon. Hopefully this is helpful. Amazon. Spend less, smile more.
Whether you are a high handicapper or regularly break par, having properly fit golf clubs is vital. For a premium custom fitting that will lower your scores, see the experts at Golf Performance Academy, located at Golf Club of Indiana. They offer many top brands, including Titleist, TaylorMade, Callaway, Payne, Cobra, and Mizuno. And they are the home for Titleist Thursdays and the new hub for PXG fittings in the Indy area. For more information, go to golfindiana.com or call 317-769-6388.
Rob Zombie, Mudvayne, Freaks on Parade Tour. Zombie, Mudvayne, together. This trip is for real. This Thursday night, Roth Music Center, with Static X and Power Man 5000. Get tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. Zombie, Mudvayne, part of the Coors Light concert series.
The Ride with JMV.
Bob Kravitz of The Athletic joins us. Hey, Bob, were you surprised at the offer sheet that Deandre Ayton agreed upon from the Pacers?
Kevin Pritchard said a couple months ago that the team was going to be very active. This is the kind of thing they don't do. I like the fact that they are saying we're going to be players. If Ayton comes here, he is without question the biggest free agent in the Pacers have ever had.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays, 3 to 6.
On 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Querry. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
I think people jumped on because they realized that we said this is a more manageable pop quiz,
yeah,
right?
Like, oh, substitute teacher's here? Yeah, I'm going to show up to that class.
Zach Brown tickets help, too.
Well, that as well. Have seen Zach Brown Band in concert. They are terrific.
What? Can I ask a really dumb question?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of music would you list Zach Brown as?
I would call it a little bit more upbeat country.
Like country rock, kind of?
Sure. You, Mark?
I wouldn't know.
Really?
I'm not a country guy.
I mean, like, you know, we're not talking like old school country here,
right,
by any means.
It's fast paced, right? Yeah. Isn't it kind of like a country version of Mumford & Sons?
Fast, but yeah, I would say if those two had a, well, if country and Mumford & Sons had a baby, it'd be Zach Brown Band. He's got a great look as well.
Now, what about the, isn't there another band called the Avett Brothers?
Yeah.
What kind of music is that?
I would not know.
I don't know. I don't know how you describe Brown, him.
Zach Brown's beard is thick. Did you guys happen to see the, well, I'm not going to say the name because it could be an answer to the pop quiz.
Folk rock is what the Avett Brothers are listed at.
It's okay.
American folk rock.
We'll talk after the pop quiz on that one.
Ooh.
Phone lines are crowded. Mark Dykton, mm-hmm. Jake, in number 1 through 8?
We will go with number 4.
And we didn't really discuss this. Do you want to stick with, you do 1 through 5, I'll do 2 and 4?
Sure.
Okay. Number 4 is who, Mark?
Music Mac.
Music Mac. Good to hear from you.
How are you guys doing?
We're doing wonderful. Yourself?
Great.
You sound excited to be here, Mac.
I am. I'm excited I got through.
Mac is usually, correct if I'm wrong, Mac, but you're more of an afternoon guy, right?
Yeah, but I listen to the morning show every morning.
Well, we much appreciate that.
Well, if you've listened to today's show, I feel like we've given out virtually all these answers.
Mac, I hope the car's due for an oil change because Jiffy Lube is probably going to be giving you a free oil change because you're going to go 5 for 5. I'm very confident in that, okay?
Okay.
All right, question number 1 for you, Mac.
All business here.
That's right. Scott Dixon won the Honda Indy Toronto IndyCar race yesterday. It's his 52nd career IndyCar win. Which all-time great did Dixon tie for the second most wins in IndyCar history? Was it A.J. Foyt, Michael Andretti, Johnny Rutherford, or Mario Andretti?
Mario Andretti.
Okay.
Uh-huh. All right, number 2 here, Music Mac. The runner-up at the 150th British Open was who? Cameron Jones, Cameron Young, Cam Smith, or Rory McIlroy?
Cameron Jones.
Cameron Jones. Okay. Jake, number 3.
Or Cameron Young.
Nope. With, you have to go with one. Which one is it?
Cameron Young.
Okay.
Boy. Ruffling through the newspaper to just see. Let me double check that.
Question three.
Name.
The Pacers finished their five-game summer league on Sunday. What former Butler guard was the Pacers summer league coach?
Norris.
Okay.
All right. Number four. For the first time in Major League Baseball history, the first two picks in their draft, which was last night, were sons of former major leaguers. Can you name either of these two longtime NL dads who saw their sons go 1 and 2 overall? Long time. 32 combined years these two played in the league.
Mac is furiously Googling.
No, I'm not. I'm
Mac,
not
I, I'd say one of the, well, I mean, you are 3 for 3 so far, so I can't give any hints.
What? How about a team they played on?
Boy, like I said, I all I'm going to say is, you know, when you're in school and you really look forward to these, don't you, Jake?
Oh, well, yeah. Well, like, I mean, you might. Groundhog, really, yeah, Arbor. Really look Christmas, forward to now. Thanksgiving, Valentine's, Presidents.
Holiday.
What's that?
Holiday. I don't know.
All right, last question.
I feel like we can't give them that one.
What Western Conference team won the Summer League?
Phoenix.
Phoenix Suns there for Mac. All right, let's see how he did. All business, stoic-like, from a little Cam Smith-like from Music Mac there. Scott Dixon won the her. I was trying to combine Honda and Toronto into one there.
Antano?
Yeah, definitely did not work. He won the Toronto IndyCar
race. Loud and proud.
On Sunday's 52nd career IndyCar win, which all-time great. Did Dixon tie for second?
That would be Mario Andretti.
Yes!
The runner-up in the 150th British Open, same first name as the winner, last name Young. Cameron Young was correct.
Let's go!
And you heard the audio just a few minutes ago from the Pacers Summer League coach, indeed, Ronald Norred.
Correct, though.
Question four. Took a while to get there, but Jackson Holliday was the number one pick in the Major League Draft. Andrew Jones's son, Drew Jones, was the number two pick. Jackson Holliday is the son of Matt Holliday.
That
he just said
correct.
Holliday, so we give it to him, right?
Yeah, we'll give it to him.
Guess
but
we do.
Final question, and stay on the line, Music Mac, because you're going to get music tickets regardless. But the winner of the NBA Summer League was not the Phoenix Suns. It was instead the Trailblazers of Portland.
You blew it!
Did they raise a banner for that?
Well, they got rings.
To come back tomorrow, you don't even get a lousy copy of our home game. You're a complete loser.
I mean, how many games do they have to win the Summer League?
Which I'm totally good with. I mean, 80% of the roster, Jake, is never going to
correct. This is the pinnacle, right? You're right.
In the NBA,
you're right.
Reward winning. So, yeah, I'm totally good with it. They play what? You're guaranteed 4 plus a playoff game.
So 5 games, you get a ring.
Did you guys see the other major league, former Major League Baseball player whose son got drafted in round one last night? I loved this guy.
Okay, can I guess?
Yeah, I'll give you a hint. Same letter, first and last name.
As the father, has that, you mean?
Yeah, the father.
Mm-hmm. Was the father, did he win a World Series?
I'm going to say no. Let me double check that.
But you liked him as a player?
Yeah, I really did. It's one of those players, though, that I'm like, oh my gosh, am I that old?
Bobby Bonilla.
4-time All-Star.
Okay.
Here is an aggressive hint. 4-time AL stolen base leader.
Okay, gotcha. Birthday? Boy, now I'm really going to kick myself, right? And I need the best email. And what era did this guy play?
Recently. I'd say, I'll just give you the years. 2002 to 2016.
That rules out Willie Wilson. All right, go ahead and give it to me.
Carl Crawford.
Oh, yeah. Really? He's already got a son that's...
Carl Crawford is 20.
Excuse me, Carl Crawford is 40. So yeah, I mean, his son being 20, I guess.
Yeah, okay.
The Reds drafted, I think, an 18-year-old last night.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I was on my way back a handful of years ago.
The MLB draft is wild.
Okay, so a handful of years ago, I was coming back from an IndyCar race, actually, and was delayed with my buddy Mike Stevens. We were delayed in Dallas for, like, seemingly forever. And we were talking to people that were, like, sitting around us in the gate area. Shocking, I know. And one of them was a kid that had just been drafted by the Reds as a pitcher from the University of Tennessee. Does that ring a bell, who that would be?
Yeah, I do. That was pretty early in a draft, right? Like, he was a high pick.
Seventh round, maybe?
Well, what was it that low?
I'll look and see.
Well, Nick Senzel.
I always wondered who it...
The oft-injured Nick Senzel. What year would this have been, Jake?
I'm going to guess, like, 15 or 16.
In 2016, the second overall pick was Nick Senzel out of Tennessee, and okay. He's been oft-injured.
It was not him. I'll try to track it down here. I'm certain. Okay, here we go. The seventh round. Andy Cox. Could that have been it?
Gosh, sounds like my insurance guy.
Yeah, left-handed pitcher Andy Cox. That's who it was.
Never heard of him.
Yeah, I don't think he made it past. That's the thing, man. I mean, a seventh-round pick, right?
Oh, it's brutal.
Like, nice kid. You're like, okay. He was drafted by the A's in the 37th round in 2015. But instead went to Tennessee, then moved up to the seventh round in 2016. And I don't know that he ever made it out of anywhere in the minors, right?
I need a 30 for 30 on the Major League Baseball draft.
It is fascinating.
And just everything that goes into it. And last
night,
can
you imagine, how do you know, like, a guy in the 35th round? I mean, who's in charge of scouting that deep, right?
Well, and then last night you had a guy, Jake, Kumar Rocker is his name, from Vanderbilt. Drafted the year prior, like 10th overall, sat out the entire year because contract negotiations, I think there was an injury issue as well, so doesn't play baseball over the last year, and last night he gets drafted 3rd overall. Like, can you imagine? You know, Johnny Davis sits out the whole year, and all of a sudden he comes back and he gets drafted 7 spots higher.
Yeah, I mean, this kid was drafted in the 7th round. It looks like the highest level that he made it was the A-plus Florida League, the A-Midwest League. I mean.
It sounds like your report card.
That's right.
We're going to give our Home Run Derby picks to close out the show. And boy, Jake and Mark, do I have something that you two are going to lose your you-know-what about.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
We'll do that next here on Kevin Aquari, rounding out here on a Monday.
Fine jewelry from Shane Company makes a great gift because it has so much sentimental value. It can hold a memory, carry a story, or signify a special event in your life. We design our jewelry in-house to ensure every piece is crafted to the highest standards. And we back that up with our free lifetime warranty. Whether you get a diamond necklace, a tennis bracelet, or a stunning 3-stone anniversary ring, Shane Company's classic styles have a beauty and elegance that will be appreciated forever. We also have trending new styles, like our 14-karat gold zodiac charms, fun paperclip chains, luminous opal earrings and pendants, as well as a truly special limited edition collection featuring cherry pink tourmaline sourced by Tom Shane. Make your gift even more special by personalizing it with a birthstone or an engraving. Capture your sentiment with a gift from Shane Company.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business, Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
Hey, it's JMV for the absolute best in realty, Mark Deedle Realty. 317-755-4232. That's 317-755-4232. Online, markdeedle.com. That's Mark DIETEL.com today. So let's talk about Tim in Indianapolis. After his mother passed away, he needed to sell her home. He hired Mark Deedle, and he was really glad that he did. Mark listed the home, marketed it heavily, and had it sold in days at $16,000 over list price. Mark is a pro who made that process easy for Tim and his family. Mark Deedle has a guarantee for you. Multiple offers on your home in 3 days, or he is going to list it for free. That's Mark Deedle Realty, 317-755-4232, 317-755-4232. MarkDeedle.com, that's Mark DIETEL.com today.
Sip and save at Circle K with our great new drink subscription. Join Sip and Save today and enjoy one drink a day, every day for just $5.99 a month. Enjoy your favorite Circle K ice cold fountain drink, Froster, or freshly ground coffee every day. That's 30 drinks a month for only $5.99. So sip and save at Circle K. Sign up in store or at CircleK.com. Circle K, take it easy.
Hi, it's Steve Mann. Have you heard the commercials for the Mark Patrick Stop Smoking seminars? And they said only $49.99 and it could work for you. So I thought, that's not even a week's worth of smoking. So I went. And guess what? It did work for me. You know, my friends and family are still amazed. I quit smoking. I didn't have cravings, anxiety, or weight gain. Listen, I don't know how it works, but I know it works because I'm living proof and it's 100% guaranteed. So what do you got to lose? I'll tell you what you got to lose. A very bad habit.
Join Mark Patrick Seminars and stop smoking now without cravings, irritability, weight gain, or your money back. Only $49.99 guaranteed. Designed to work without anxiety, irritability, or weight gain for only $49.99, become a non-smoker. That's right. Seminar times are 8 to 10 p.m. on Thursday, July 28th at the Hampton Inn and Suites in Fishers, and 2 to 4 p.m. on Saturday, July 30th at the La Quinta Inn and Suites South in Indianapolis. Registration 30 minutes before seminar.
The NASCAR Cup Series races at the Verizon 200 at the Brickyard. Coverage next Sunday at noon on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
16 minutes before the hour of 10 o'clock. Final 16 minutes. This is when we really start hitting our stride, isn't it?
This is Zach Brown Band, Jake. Homegrown.
Yeah, this is cool. This definitely sounds country to me.
Yeah. It's not the Applebee's commercial. We just got in a heated debate off air about...
You guys are about
the Applebee's
fancy like. That's the other Applebee's, like, popular. Walker Hayes. I can sound really dumb talking country music, so I probably should just stop. But yeah, I think that's the one, Mark.
Okay. I'll take your word for it.
Now, what about Abbott Brothers? Did you find them?
Yeah, I found them. I mean, yeah.
Play something from them. I want to hear what they sound like.
Okay, give me a minute. You guys.
Should we save that for 10:03? Is that our 10:03 segment?
That's
today?
Right.
Michael wants to know, Jake, recommendations for Newton, Iowa this weekend. He is heading there for the IndyCar doubleheader.
Okay, recommendations. First off, here's my understanding. If you are camping at the racetrack at Iowa Speedway, which they are allowed, you know, which people do, they are actually opening up. Hy-Vee is the title sponsor, which is a grocery store and gas station chain in the Iowa, in the Plains states. They're opening one in Zionsville. But they actually are building a grocery store at the racetrack, and you can order food from the grocery store and have it delivered to your camp location.
Whoa.
At Iowa Speedway.
That's pretty good.
Newton, Iowa, here are my recommendations. If you are driving there, on your way there in West, depending on how much time you're allowing yourself, in West Branch, Iowa, which is just this side of Newton by probably 25, 30 minutes, in West Branch, Iowa is the home of Herbert Hoover, and his library is there. It is actually, it doesn't take a tremendous amount of time to go through, but it is pretty fascinating. I recommend it. It's right off the interstate, off of 80. When in Iowa, you absolutely must go to Marshalltown, which is the next town over from Newton as well, and get a Made Right sandwich. They are loose meat sandwiches. They are indigenous to Iowa. They are fantastic. I've been craving one for like 2 years. Also, Riverside, Iowa. This is pretty fascinating. Again, outside Newton by about 25 minutes. Riverside, Iowa. Did you guys, either one of you, ever watch Star Trek?
No.
I've not seen the movies, but no. Okay, I was not a Star Trek watcher either, but you're familiar with Captain Kirk.
Yeah.
Sure.
So Captain Kirk In one episode of the original Star Trek, Captain Kirk mentions that he is from a place on Earth called Iowa. So the town of Riverside, Iowa, in the late 80s was, you know, they'd lost all their commerce, they'd lost their jobs, and the mayor was like, we got to do something to, you know, get relevance again. So he wrote to the writer of Star Trek, who was still living, and asked permission to be able to claim that Riverside was the town in Iowa that Captain Kirk was from. And they were granted permission. So Star Trek, the TV show, takes place in like the year 2350 or whatever. So the town of Riverside fictionally claimed that it is the future birthplace of Captain Kirk. And the entire town has been overtaken now by Star Trek. They have a Star Trek convention once a year. They built a little house that says future birthplace of Captain Kirk. The Star Trek Enterprise is in downtown Riverside. The whole town is themed around Star Trek. So if you like Star Trek, that's right up your alley. The other thing is there is a casino. I mean, that's the big thing. So if you go 30 minutes the opposite side of Newton towards Des Moines, Belterra Casino is there. I think it's called... No, Argosy. I don't know. One of the casinos, but it's really nice. It's a really, really nice casino. And you know, that's the thing to do.
6 hours and 32 minutes.
Yeah. The town of Newton is just, I mean, the racetrack's right off of I-80. There's not much
MS
in the town.
To Iowa Speedway.
Yep. Well,
here's some Avid Brothers for you.
This is what I'll be listening to next Sunday when I drive back from Newton.
Jake, who's the NASCAR driver that has his name of the drive? The Speedway's located at...
Rusty Wallace.
Boom, boom. 3333 Rusty Wallace Drive.
He was the owner originally.
Oh, he was
the
owner of it.
Now, right behind the Iowa Speedway...
And we're going doubleheader this weekend, Saturday and Sunday.
Correct. Right behind the Speedway is an airport strip that Rocky Marciano, the legendary boxer Rocky Marciano, was coming back from actually an event at the home of the Granatellis in Chicago. And they were having... They were supposed to fly, I believe he was flying to Des Moines, but they ran into fog or something like that and tried to land in Newton and had issues with the plane. The plane went down, and that's how Rocky Marciano was killed. And I think I've told you guys, there's a farmhouse behind the Speedway. And a couple of years ago, we were there. We had some open time, you know, so I went over to the farmhouse and knocked on the door, and this guy answers, and I said, hey, I know this is a totally ridiculous and bizarre question, but do you happen to know in the area where exactly Rocky Marciano's plane went down? And the guy said, I'm almost directly quoting, he goes, man, I'm not going to lie to you. My family's owned this farmland for like 100 years. My great-grandfather, my grandfather, my dad, this guy was probably 50. And he said, I grew up in this house, and I have always wondered why no one has ever knocked on the door and asked that question. He's like, I'm totally serious. No one's ever asked that, but it is on our property. I'll show you. So we went out, we got on one of those gator tractors, went out in the forest, and in the woods, there were all of a sudden, then we went out in the woods probably 200 yards, and there was a clearing of the woods, like probably the size of a football field. And you could see the tree line where it had been shaved down. I mean, this was 50, 60 years ago. And he said, this was all cleared out by the NTSB because when the plane went down, they cleared all of this stuff out. And that's why there's no trees here, because this is where the plane landed. And he actually said, like 10 years ago, his daughter had friends and they were playing hide and go seek or capture the flag or whatever. And she found, I kid you not, found a medallion, and it was a medallion that was off of Rocky Marciano's necklace.
Wow.
And they returned it to Rocky Marciano's family. That's right behind the racetrack.
Sounds like the episode of Ozark I'm going to watch tonight.
So you weren't worried about going into the woods with some dude?
No, not at all.
Not at all? No. They're out. Come out in the woods. They're just clearing 200 yards out. Just keep walking. I'll be right behind you. Yeah. That would scare the bejesus
out
of me.
It was broad
daylight. Keep your hands down while you're
That doesn't matter. You're in the woods. What's that going to do?
Yeah. If you've watched too much Deliverance. He actually had his kids. He was like, hey, your kids come. I mean, it was like his whole family was there.
It was a family, a family get-together.
Really nice guy. Really nice guy.
You guys are going to freak out at this, all right?
Okay.
So Greg, loyal listener Greg, DMs me and goes, my niece plays volleyball at Eastern Kentucky University and has an NIL deal with Buc-ee's.
Come on.
Sign me up.
niece plays volleyball at Eastern Kentucky, and she has an NIL deal with Buc-ee's. And I said, are you serious? And he goes, yep, not many NIL opportunities in Richmond, Kentucky.
That's the one I was at just recently.
So what is the NIL deal?
Yeah, I'm going to have to ask, right? What does that entail?
Do we know, is she from Indiana?
I do not know that.
Can she become an official show correspondent?
Can we get her on here?
You're going to have her, you know, send some...
let's talk more about Buc-ee's.
Beaver Nuggets for life. We have a new weekly guest here on the show. Man.
Weekly? Daily? What are you talking about?
No, hold on. Oh, here we go.
Can you imagine?
Is it Molly Roeder?
I do not know the last name.
Wait a minute. Is that Jim Roeder's daughter?
No, this guy's name's Greg.
Well, he said niece, right?
Yeah.
Molly Roeder is from Roncalli High School, plays volleyball at Eastern Kentucky. Oh, wait, daughter of John. Okay, hold on.
So you think the whole team just gets what? Pre-game meal, we got Beaver Nuggets.
Wait a minute. Hold on.
Get that brisket,
hold on,
man.
Hold on.
Get the brisket.
It could be Megan Duffy. Megan Duffy is from Tri-West High School, a sophomore.
Oh, they got a pipeline here.
New Albany, Anna Perikia. There's a lot of Perikias that went to Ritter. She's from Our Lady of Providence High School in New Albany, plays volleyball at Eastern Kentucky. So there are three. New Washington, Indiana. Where's New Washington? Audrey Ayton.
New Washington just sounds like it's down south.
And Tara Hote from Chloe Mason. It might be Chloe Mason because she's a senior. She's from Tara Hote, went to Tara Hote North.
So you're saying the seniors got the more NIL clout?
Probably a little more clout, yeah.
Yeah, New Washington.
Washington's just way down there.
Yeah, just northeast of...
Well, it's a Hoosier hotbed, the Eastern Kentucky volleyball team.
I mean, this is unbelievable. So you think Eastern Kentucky, just the whole athletic department's got NIL deals with Buc-ee's?
Isn't that awesome?
Man, I need to go work on my volleyball skills.
Well, Mark's daughters are now being recruited. Hey,
EKU, come on. Come on. Actually, just have Buc-ee's call us.
Can you imagine? Like, I mean, I would have Buc-ee's come just to... If Buc-ee's is doing NIL deals, they should come... Mark, just to build the locker rooms, right? Like pattern after
the bathrooms alone. Don't even worry about it. It's like a private resort in there.
Mark, who you
could
going
get a
with?
Lot of thinking done in those Buc-ee's restrooms. I'm not going to lie. After that drive, I was like, you know what? I just need to sit here for a few minutes.
I'm glad you stopped there. Your pick tonight for the Home Run Derby.
Ponder, what's wrong?
It's like, what'd you call it? It's a private suite. Is that what you call
it? Yeah,
it's
a private suite. Just go in there. Goes up. The walls go all the way up to the ceiling.
They are like immaculate. They're like marble and granite walls.
You're looking around. You're like, this is some fine masonry right here.
It is. No, you're right. Juan Soto is going to win the Home Run Derby, right?
No, Jake, Kyle Schwarber.
Plus 600 on Juan Soto. Plus 290 for Schwarber. Should we just sprinkle a little money on Pujols?
No, I'm
not. Plus 2,400. I feel like sometimes you get these guys with big home run numbers, and they overthink the Home Run Derby.
So who's the odds-on favorite?
Pete Alonso plus 185.
He's a back-to-back winner.
Schwarber plus 290, and then Juan Soto plus 600. Pujols at plus 2,400. So if you put $10 on Albert to win 240.
I've already got a financial stake on Schwarber, so he's my guy tonight.
How about the longest home run distance, over under 491.5 feet?
I'd take the over, right?
Did you look up your dimensions for the Dodger Stadium?
No, I need to probably see if Jake's got a geometry class that we can do a little A squared plus B squared equals C squared.
Dodger Stadium, by the way, is awesome.
I can't wait to see who you land on after you figure out the dimensions. So after thorough research, I'm going with...
Did you guys see the home run? Maybe it was in the Futures game that guy hit 527 feet.
No, I didn't see that one.
See, take the over. I'm telling you. Was it the Futures? That means the Futures star. Was it Jack Floyd, the 17-year-old phenom?
No, it was his alternate universe brother from Great Britain.
Jack Floyd. What was the university?
Shorter. Was it Shorter University in Georgia?
Yeah, no one over 6 feet.
Mark, you said...
what? I'd fit that category.
Okay.
Mark, you said Field Yates tomorrow?
Field Yates, 740.
So we'll talk about the Home Run Derby again tomorrow. So the All-Star Game is tomorrow night, is that right?
Tomorrow night, yeah.
Yeah, Home Run Derby tonight, All-Star Game tomorrow. We're also going to start to get into some Colts conversation. a week out.
A week out. That's crazy.
From report day as well. So what were you thinking, Mark? Kind of our top 10 most indispensable Colts?
Yeah. Everybody's definition of that is different. So I think that could be pretty interesting to go through.
So we'll
I've got
that.
One on there that will surprise you.
We'll do
Jack
that
Floyd
tomorrow.
Not Jack Floyd.
He's a long snapper.
Thank you. Luke Rhodes, all pro long snapper there. Thank you to Will Haskett for joining us. Really all major golf season. That will be up on the podcast. Scott Agness as well. Thank you to everybody for tuning in to Kevin and Corey on this Monday. We will be back tomorrow at 7 a.m. Talk to you then.